Yes, Mr.
Yes.
Mr. Frazier.
Here.
Ms. Jordan.
Here.
Mr. Lance.
Here.
Mr. Moss.
Here.
Mr. Seiber.
Here.
Ms. Seymour.
Here.
We have 7 members present.
Thank you. First item on the agenda is a liquor license request for the MSC Suites Hotel. That is first to do.
Yes. Thank you. This is just a, on October 3rd, 2011, council approved a request from Boykin Southfield, LLC. It was for the transfer of a liquor license at the Embassy Suite Hotel. It was basically just a simple membership interest change in the Resort B license. At that time, the notice that came from the state of Michigan, there was a typographical error in the resolution. It listed that they wanted to transfer all membership interests through the merger of Boykin Southfield LLC, Boykin Hotel Properties, to the new member Braveheart Investors LP, and it should have read Braveheart Mez Incorp LLC. So this is just a simple house cleaning typographical error sent from the state, and we didn't want to make any changes, you know, until we brought it back before your honorable body.
I move to Rule 10.
Support.
Motion by Mr. Seiber, supported by Ms. Jordan, to immediately to act and invoke Rule 10. All in favor?
Aye.
I'd move the liquor license request for Embassy Suites Hotel with the correction to the name.
Support.
Supported by Mr. Frazier to approve this with the liquor license request with the amendments or corrections. Is that correct?
That's correct.
All right.
Actually, the attorney is present. I think he just wants to say 2 words.
I just want to say thank you.
All right, so we need to do a vote.
There's a motion on the floor. Yeah, all in favor? Mm-hmm. Are you talking about a roll call?
Yeah, well, I think we need a roll call.
No,
we don't. All right, okay, so we don't. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion is carried.
Okay, thank you, counsel.
And then,
thank you. The second item on your agenda is a liquor license request from Mai's Garapa. It's a new Mexican restaurant located on Northwestern Highway in the Sunset Strip Mall, I believe it is. It's also known as the mall with the big guitar. They have been at that location, I believe, for approximately 6 months. They are requesting to transfer the ownership of a Class C license, which is currently in escrow in the city of White Lake, Michigan, to the city of Southfield. The owner of the restaurant is present this evening. All the necessary documents and approvals have been received from the city's department, and it's requested that your honorable body give consideration of this request. And the petitioner is in the back room.
This is not a mirage. Sunset Strip is one.
Do we
have
a question? Do we need to hear from the petitioner?
Okay. It's up to you. I think he has some menus he just wants to.
That's fine, but I mean, we already know that we're
okay.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure if it's a La Mirage or a Sunset Strip. The one with the guitar.
It's La Mirage.
It's La Mirage.
Mm-hmm.
Sunset Strip's on
the. Yeah, but so it's a La Mirage. I'm sorry.
Here are some menus.
Here.
Thank you.
Well, if you want to come before the council at our regular meeting and talk about your restaurant, you're able to do that. Just see the clerk and let us know. On television. All right, so
did you want to do a roll call on this one also?
Mark, I want to have any questions.
I do have one question. Is the telephone number going to be the home telephone number of the vice president, or is that just a temporary number? I saw it was a 734 number.
What was the question?
In here, it says the telephone number of the establishment is 734-657-9474, and on the next page, that number is the home number of the vice president.
That was a temporary number for when we were doing the process. We still hadn't opened up the restaurant.
Madam President, we don't have his name or address for the record.
Would you give your name or an address for the record? You.
The address?
Your name and address.
Oh, yes, mine?
Your name and business address for the record.
Okay, so go write it down.
No.
27.
What is your name?
Ricardo Fonseca.
And can we have your address, please?
2731 Rhodes Drive, Troy, Michigan. Zip code.
That's your business address?
No, that's.
I want your business address.
Business address is 29555 Northwestern Highway, Suite 312, Southfield, Michigan.
It says
308
here.
It was a double. We rented out two locations, 308 and 312. All right.
Nancy, could you check the mic? It doesn't sound like we're hearing him. Is this?
Testing 1, 2, 3. Okay, you can just talk to the little mic. It's okay.
That mic doesn't pick up. People just talk right into it.
Ms. Seymour, I don't know that the petitioner understands the importance of coming back on the next regular televised meeting. So I don't know if you picked up on that. We can be supportive of this tonight, but you'd get more publicity if you came back at a televised meeting where people would hear about your restaurant, the whole community would hear about your restaurant.
Well, the problem was that it was like a very recent thing that's why I had to make time to come in today.
Okay.
I was just told on Friday
your
to come in.
As far as coming back.
Or if you want to send someone that can speak for you, because that gives you an opportunity to speak to the whole community, and that is taped, it's live, and then it's taped and it's repeated. So a lot of people will hear that if you want to take advantage of that.
Oh, yeah, that'll be great.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
what we have is an opportunity to add 50 parking spaces to Inglenook Park and also improve our stormwater management, which is consistent with our attitude toward the environment, support of the our staff in that regard. And what is necessary is that we, again, the rule 10 is simply granting authority for staff to apply for the grant. We'll have to come back for acceptance if we are successful. But there are deadlines involved in the application process. So we're requesting the
information. Make a motion to the rule 10 to give authorization for the grant.
I'd like to introduce this, and then I'll turn it over to our attorney for explanation. Yes, we have two ordinances that we would like to do on an emergency basis. The very first one is the controlled substance. We've all heard it on the news. We've heard it on read in the papers or heard about the problems with the synthetic marijuana and bath salts, commonly known as K2, that has caused a great deal of concern up to and including deaths with people that have ingested these substances. And the state is working on coming up with controlled laws to control it, but There are several communities, and we have joined with the communities to be ahead of the state and say we don't want those substances in our community because it deteriorates the health and welfare of our population and our residents. So we talked about this at our legislative committee and asked the city attorney to write ordinances. Write an ordinance for this and bring it to the council for approval. Mm-hmm. And with that, I will turn it over to our attorney to
with an immediate need to act.
Yes.
Okay. As Mr. Fraser indicated, obviously everybody's very familiar with this subject. I took a little bit of a different approach than a couple ordinances that have been. That have been enacted last week, that being West Bloomfield and Shelby Township. I worked with the Michigan State Police Lab. They're working with the state and coming up with the definitions for these substances. And as you're probably all aware, the publicity has indicated that the real inherent problem here is that, you know, as soon as you ban an element, some kind of chemical compound, you know, the manufacturers, which could be anywhere in the world, they're suggesting maybe a lot of it's coming from China. So they just change it. So they change it a little bit, take that substance out, and then you haven't banned that substance because the chemical that you said was illegal is no longer in there. So the real problem has been staying one step ahead of the manufacturers. And so the Michigan State lab chemists have kind of come up with I think a pretty broad definition of the synthetic marijuana, which they define as being a synthetic cannabinoid, and a synthetic cathinone, which would be bath salts. And they described it kind of broadly. You'll see it's very technical, and I had long discussions with her, the chemist, so that we could kind of understand where they were going. But what they do is they talk about compounds and structures, chemical compounds and structures, that have certain qualities and components. And if it meets that quality or component, then it's outlawed. They then would say, for example, one of these JWH, which is a synthetic type compound that was manufactured. So it gives examples, but we're not limited to those, just those chemical compounds. For example, and that's what West Bloomfield in particular did. They just listed the chemical compounds, and for now it's probably good enough, but maybe a month from now it won't be. So we think it's broad. We think it'll give us authority over these kind of structures in the future, and that's why, again, we differ a little bit. But in essence, that's what it does. It bans these synthetic marijuana and these bath salts and any of those chemical compounds within there. As Mr. Fraser indicated as well, we were asking for a Rule 10 tonight, and then we would adopt it tonight as an emergency ordinance so that we didn't have to wait for another meeting to then, you know, introduce tonight and enact later. So that's what you have in front of you. And basically it just makes it unlawful to possess, use, or traffic in any of these substances. And traffic in basically is defined to mean, you know, selling it, offering it for sale, having it on your property for sale. So we hope to obviously work on and get it not just out of the possession of you know, minors in particular and others, but also get it off the shelves if it does exist in the city. So that was the intent. That's what you have in front of you.
Hearing that, I move for a Rule 10.
Motion by Mr. Fraser, supported by Mr. Fiber, to have immediately act and vote for Rule 10.
I have one question. Ms. Ward, is the highest penalty that we can offer just a misdemeanor?
It is, Ms. Jordan, and that's simply because the only authority we have is for a misdemeanor. The state, and they're looking at, again, many of these same kind of definitions, they're going to go felony. So that, if the state does act, these similar kind of offenses will be felonies. Ours will still be fine. I mean, we can still have some power. Maybe it's in the future, even if the state has enacted it as a felony and there's a minor violation, we might elect, our police department might send it over and say, go city ordinance rather than we take it state. So I think it's fine, but you're right. I mean, we're limited to the 90 days and $500 fine, or both.
All right, thank you.
All right, all in favor?
Aye.
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 I'm sorry, Mr. Lance.
I'm just thinking of how to explain what I mean. If somebody is caught selling this or using what are the procedures in court for being arrested and all that?
Well, what would happen is, obviously, we would have to take the product and have it chemically looked at by the Michigan State Lab, and they would do an analysis of what the components are, and then measure that against the definition within our ordinance. Now, they're very comfortable with the definition of our ordinance, so it would be very easy for them to make that analysis. But we would write them, probably go complaint and warrant. They would come to our office. We would have the lab look at the substance, and then we would write a misdemeanor complaint and warrant, and it would go through the court system that way.
In the meantime, can the chemical be changed? That's not involved in the law.
Again, Mr. Lance, that's what the problem has been. But if you look at the way we've defined these substances, it talks about a chemical structure, a similar chemical structure. So if it's like that structure, it will be a violation of this ordinance. It doesn't have to be a certain type of chemical component. So they will measure it against, is it a structure? Is it a chemical structure that is like what is within the ordinance? And if it's that substance, a similar substance, it will be prohibited as well.
That's not
going to
hold up.
You know what, Mr. Lance, it will, because it's chemically, you can measure this. These chemists can go through and look at the properties of the way that they've synthesized these chemicals. And they're able to then, this definition is exactly what the lab would like to see, because they're very comfortable with measuring against this.
We'll see what happens.
I don't see him in the room, but Paul Condino called earlier today. He represents, I believe, the Associated Food Dealers.
Yeah,
Food and Petroleum Dealership Association. And he wanted to thank council for considering adopting this resolution. They're in full support of it. And he said if he wasn't present, he would support it.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
All right, so we're ready to vote?
It looks like there's a hand.
Yes. Oh.
Resolution form that was adopted by the Oakland County Commission on June the 7th last week, and it more so spoke to support for federal and state legislation criminalizing the sale, display, and possession of synthetic marijuana. This resolution is a resolution that basically was brought forth in 2010. Parts of it by now State Rep. Tim Grimel came back to us and for us because of the recent events with synthetic marijuana and K2. And basically, it was drafted by Commissioner Bill Dwyer, who sits on the Republican caucus, who was a former chief of police in Farmington Hills. And he wrote it basically to support legislation that is coming, because it's coming forth very soon, within the next 3 weeks or so, maybe with federal legislation coming forth in July. So I just wanted to make sure that I shared this with the council as you are discussing this issue, because the same type of questions came before us and were discussed. Questions as far as the ordinance at the local level only being a misdemeanor versus this really being able to address this problem with more so stiff penalty. So I just wanted to make sure that you had this in your discussion. I don't know if it's too late for anyone to make copies, but I do want to give it to the council president.
Are you going to stay or do you have to leave?
I can stay.
Sure. What do you want to do?
You want me to copy and give it to council in your packet?
I just wanted to bring this forth because I remember during the discussion with medical marijuana, there were a lot of questions about what is the county doing and where is the state going to stand? Are all these municipalities standing alone making decisions in a vacuum? And yes, Royal Oak, Troy, and Waterford, they have come up with the emergency ordinances, and it is up to the city's discretion, but I just wanted to make sure that you had this information.
Well, thank you. We appreciate that.
You're very welcome.
Thank you, Commissioner Jackson.
I was just going to make a motion if that's the right time. So I don't know if it voided it or not.
All right.
All
right. We need to vote on the roll call.
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
I move to pass the amendment of Chapter 123 of the Controlled Substances Title IX as an emergency ordinance.
Section,
yeah.
Are we, is this the one-step thing that we're going to introduce in an act?
If we use the language, Mr. Moss, of the recommended resolution, then we would get an ordinance number?
Yeah.
All right. It's being enacted as the emergency ordinance pursuant to Section 4.19 of the Charter. 1592.
All right. So ordinance 1592 is being introduced.
And an act.
Well, don't we pass it first and then we introduce the other?
You can do it in the two steps. That's fine. Yeah. We're just doing it at the same meeting. That's fine.
All right. Motion by Mr. Moss.
Mm-hmm.
For the Jordan that we, the resolution says introduce and an act.
Let's do it in two steps. Introduce 1592 and then an act.
Motion 1592 be introduced. We have a motion and support. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed. Motion is carried.
Now I'll move to enact Ordinance 1592 as an emergency ordinance pursuant to Section 4.19 of the Charter.
Motion to enact
Ordinance
1592 on emergency basis. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed. Motion is carried.
Now this, I think I understood what the attorney told us earlier, and that it becomes effective as quickly as it's published?
As soon as it's published, yes.
Okay, the second emergency ordinance that I'd like to introduce this evening is a proposed amendment to Title IX of the police regulations by adding a new Chapter 125A, regulation of the ignition, discharge, and use of consumer fireworks. The state of Michigan has changed the laws concerning fireworks, and I don't think that it's my personal view is I don't think it's in the best interest of the health and welfare of the residents of the city of Southfield, but the state has already done it, and what they've done is they've sort of taken the wraps off of the kind of fireworks that are allowed to be used. And it's going to be the real noisy ones, the ones that lift off the ground, that are just short of the ones that you go to the fairgrounds to see or go downtown to see. Those are demonstration or display fireworks. These are consumer fireworks that people used to have to go out of state and secret them back in and set them off. But now they're legal in the state of Michigan. So what we are attempting to do is put as much control on the sale of these as we possibly can by making sure that they're done in the right zoning and the building that they're sold in is fireproof and the whole thing. So I will turn it over to our attorney for further explanation.
Thanks, Mr. Fraser. If I can pass out, we made one small change on this morning. In speaking with Jim Dundas, the fire marshal, he had one request, and I'll tell you briefly what that is as we go through this. So as Mr. Fraser indicated, this is another ordinance that we're proposing to do a work plan on site and then introduce in an act as an emergency ordinance. The reason for that, obviously, July 4th, the holidays are coming up, and the thought is if we're going to ban them to the extent that we can under state law, that this would be the appropriate time to put this into effect. So the state law basically has changed and reflects now that many of those kind of bigger type fireworks that used to be banned and used to travel out of state to acquire, those are now legal in Michigan. And along with that, the state took away the authority of the local communities and the local government to prohibit them within their jurisdiction. Not 100%, but they're restricting our ability to say you can't have them within our city. So they're allowed to be sold, they're allowed to be used. What the state said is you cities can enact an ordinance that governs the ignition, discharge, and use of consumer fireworks, that's fine. But you cannot prohibit
or regulate the use of consumer fireworks on certain days in the year. And they put this into a definition of a national holiday. The national holidays are listed within the ordinance, and those track state law. Had a question this morning, is, well, what about some other holidays? Well, these are the state holidays, the national holidays, that the state law says you cannot regulate the use of consumer fireworks on the day of that holiday, the day before that holiday, or the day after. So during that three-day period of each of those national holidays, the city has no power to regulate the use of those consumer fireworks. We have to allow them to be used. So what this would do, what this ordinance would do, is go ahead and prohibit consumer fireworks on every other day of the year, but for each of those national holiday three-day periods. That's what the kind of the thrust of this ordinance would do. It also would provide that enforcement would be done, and here's the kind of small tweak we made, that it would be done by the city fire marshal or the law enforcement officers, our police officers, because obviously the fire marshal isn't, you know, necessarily here 24/7. So if something occurs at 2 o'clock in the morning, we believe that the police should go out and handle a violation. As Mr. Dundas indicated today, though, we ought to give authority not just to the fire marshal and the police to enforce this, but also the fire chief and a designee of the fire chief or the fire marshal. So the only change that we made from the one that was in your packet appears in section 9.605, and that's where we added the city fire marshal, fire chief, or their respective designee, or a sworn police officer can enforce this violation. We propose to make this a civil infraction as opposed to a misdemeanor, so the person would be brought into court on a ticket, and there could be fines as provided in our civil infraction ordinance, which can be anywhere up to $500, and so that would be the potential penalty. So to the extent that the city is allowed to regulate, we have attempted to do that to the fullest, and unfortunately we just can't do anything on those 3 days in terms of the use of fireworks. As Mr. Fraser indicated, though, we are continuing to enforce our zoning law. So even though the state has said sale of fireworks is totally now assumed by the state, you can't do anything about the sale of fireworks. But we are still taking the position, as are many cities, that where these fireworks are sold is still a zoning issue. So if you want to put up a tent somewhere and sell fireworks, you're right. You have to go to the state to get your permit to sell the fireworks. But the fact that you're putting a tent up is a land use, and you're trying to sell something. And so we've gone through our land use process, and that goes to the building department, and there's a hearing held. And so that we have continued to enforce that. So that is kind of where we're not giving up on our zoning or our other police power.
I'd move a roll tent.
Smart.
What's the roll tent?
I'm supported by Mr. Frazier.
Yes.
I was for by Mr. Frazier to immediately act and vote the rule 10. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? All right.
Then I would move the ordinance to amend Title 9 Police Regulations of the Code of the City of Southfield by adding a new chapter, 1.5A, Regulation of the Ignition, Discharge, and Use of Consumer Fireworks.
Appropriately regulated for safety purposes on a local level, but
I
think we'd be here. We would know what was happening. I don't know that the state is going to be in every jurisdiction watching what's happening. But yes, that's where we are. That's what the state law has left.
There was a story in the news
demonstration of fireworks is what I normally see, and I think everybody else does. How would a fire marshal or policeman be able to go through all these various sundry of explosives at the same time? In other words, you're enforcing this. How in the world do you check everybody out at the time of the blowing up fireworks?
So,
you know, I mean, before, when you've seen them go up, and they were unusually strong, you know, there may be one or two guys that brought them in from the state. Now you're going to have these things exploding everywhere.
Well, if it's during the 3-day period of a national holiday,
yeah,
it'll be allowed.
Yeah.
It'll be allowed. If it's some other time, the only thing that would be allowed would be a low impact firework, which is basically a ground or handheld sparkling device. So anything that shoots up then would not be a low level firework.
I just can't believe they did that. You know, we've held off on this for so long due to injuries and problems and pressure upon local governments to not only enforce it, but, you know, for potential fires and things like that, and injuries, that would put it all on our backs. And it would be a tough one.
Specifically, how do we prohibit those businesses that set up shop? How can we be proactive with the business owners that have the large ones that are going and set up shop for a couple of days? How can we be above the curve by telling them, no, you won't be able to sell here, no, you can't?
Well, I know I talked to Sherry Comerford, and they've had a handful of requests already to be putting up these temporary kind of structures in these parking lots. And they've gone through their hearing, because they go through an actual process to get this temporary use permit to sell anything, not just fireworks, any product that you want.
They go through a hearing here.
They go through a hearing
the
in the building department, right. And within those requirements are all kinds of health, safety, welfare issues for the tent. Again, it's irrespective of the fact of what they're going to sell, because we know the fireworks themselves are all preempted by the state in terms of the sale. But we still look at a temporary sales outlet. We want to know that certain safety, so that the tent, the fire access, so that it's not all closed in. And so, and I know Mr. Dundas could speak to this, but there are various things between the building and the fire department they look at to make sure that this is going to be safe for whatever is being sold in that structure. I thought Mr. Comerford indicated there might be three that have been granted, and we had two more hearings scheduled for this week.
But it still has to be.
And if they don't, if they open, if they just put a tent up and we know and someone tells them, we'll go out there and ticket them and shut them down because they haven't gone through the process.
I would really like for us to be on alert, you know, that weekend, looking at those.
We are.
They set up shop, you know, because sometimes you call in and by the time you get there.
Right.
They've already taken everything down.
Isn't this peddling?
Peddling would more assume kind of an on foot. These things are, they just put a tent up or some temporary type structure in a parking lot, and they just sell. So it's not peddling per se, but it's a temporary use, and they have to go through the zoning process.
Like
Christmas trees, potentially. Other things that they might sell. You know, like when the sports teams win something and they're selling T-shirts or something, it'd be the same thing. They would put a tent up, but they would have to come through and comply with our zoning and our fire regulations for that structure.
And if I could just say, the present applicants that are before the building department and the fire department right now have done business in our city for the past several years, so they have sold fireworks in the city and they are familiar with the process. And I think Fire Marshal Dundas can confirm that. The 4 or 6 people that presently have applied. Did he have the
So, I hope they don't declare firearms under this law that they just passed. And they'll sell ammunition and $38 and bombs and everything. They'll come in from the other cities and
no, you can, no. The sale of these fireworks themselves has totally been preempted by the state. You can't, so for example, when we, in the old days, when we would approve the tent and we'd say, okay, you could sell fireworks, Fire Marshal Dundas would go in there and require all kinds of things because there's fireworks in there. Fireworks in a tent and the safety issues, and he would look at what you're selling and have all specific regulations. Now he can't do that because they have been preempted by the state in terms of the sale. But we still look at our zoning. It doesn't matter what they're selling in there. We're saying it's a temporary use in terms of a retail use, and we go through our zoning process and our building process to make sure it's done safely. But your thought is, could we just ban the sale? No, the state has taken that prerogative away.
And our license taking, they took our license away.
They took our, right.
Yeah, they took our license.
Other than
for
the display.
Right.
The display fireworks.
What was involved, Republican or Democrat? Who voted who?
Well, I would.
All right, let's
get into the loser. Well, that's a decent question.
Hmm?
Who actually passed that?
I would imagine it was a Republican controlled state legislature.
Right. I guess the training, is the vendor required to do training or kind of warning to the consumer?
All of their requirements, there are requirements for them to get a permit from the state, and they work with the state to get the permit.
Not the buyers.
Oh, I'm sorry, I thought you said the vendors.
The vendors are doing training to the buyers.
No, I don't believe there was anything.
Well, there's warning labels on.
Warning labels.
Right, but there's nothing, well, she asked.
In terms of training the person how to
use
them?
Well, I'm assuming that
you're not trained. Put the money in there.
Yes. For those that qualify to sell, do they have to display a permit in sight so that
from the state?
Well, whatever. So that when one of our law enforcement folks go there, they can see without having to chase anybody down that this is a.
Yeah, they
have to be able to produce it.
Yeah.
But it doesn't have to hang in sight.
No. That's a very good question. For a simple reason, they can counterfeit that and they can spring up all over.
Well, except if they.
At least you verify it.
Yeah.
Yeah, but that means you've got to be outside checking all these things.
Well, if they come upon a place that they haven't been before and they're selling, who would seem like you drive up there and see a permit that says this address, at this address, this is a legitimate.
But only
local.
They could check, they would be legitimate and know
yeah.
That was authentic, correct?
Yeah. And the second thing I want to bring up is the attorney did say that we can also control these by our noise ordinance. So after a certain time in the evening.
Yeah, I mean, again, we'll be going a little bit on uncharted waters, but we still believe, and most municipalities are taking the position, that we still have our police powers. And so if these things, I mean, if it's right in the middle of a residential neighborhood and it's 3 o'clock in the morning, we believe that we'll go out there, we will make contact. Acting Chief Hawkins said they will go out, they will make contact and ask the people that, you know, this is not an appropriate time for this, you've got people sleeping, and if necessary, we will ticket. So, again, we're venturing into that, but from our intent, we intend to enforce all the ordinances that we still have under our police powers.
What is the city for?
With the state?
And don't we have a fee?
Oh, we do have a fee going through building.
The bit.
Yeah, the business license, and then I don't know what the fee is.
Can we set a fee?
We have, there is a fee.
Can we set it for the person who is hired?
Well, but based on what? Because you can't treat fireworks differently now because you've been preempted. So you can only look at the structure that they're selling anything in, and so I don't think that you could put any kind of difference.
I think the license fee in the city clerk's office is $100, but building is,
they
want to say $300 or $400,
yeah.
And I don't know if fire charge is a fee also. No, okay. That might be
so
with the building.
So the building department, is that correct?
It goes
to
the
building department. If they're going to put up a tent or
whatever, they go through the building department?
Yeah,
so
correct.
Correct. All right, then we need a motion to
We didn't approve.
Oh, we haven't.
We haven't approved it.
We didn't do it.
Okay. we didn't go to the introduce.
I don't think we had.
No, we have the motion on the floor.
Right.
And then everybody talked. Then we haven't voted on it.
So we need to vote on introducing 1593. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Now we need a motion to enact.
I so move.
Support.
Motion 1593. 1593. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion has carried. 1593 is enacted.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for your time for all of you. Our next item is Pawnshops and Alternative Financial Services Study Session, Mr. Poe.
Good evening.
Good evening.
As you may recall, we introduced this item at your February 13th COW with the discussion about the need to regulate pawn shops and alternative financial services, including check cashing services, currency exchange, payday loans, and other similar services as a primary function. Currently, these services are permitted in any retail district without any regulation at all. At that time, the council passed a 180-day moratorium, which is in effect until August 11, 2012, and directed the Planning Department and the Planning Commission to prepare draft regulations for your consideration. We have done that, and we have gone through a process with the Planning Commission, held a public hearing, and are making some recommendations. Tonight is just a first study session for your consideration with regards to regulating alternative financial services and pawn shops. Simply, what we're recommending is that they be regulated as special land uses in the B3 district only. And in your packet are a number of terms and definitions that are related to both of these types of businesses. It also talks about parking requirements. But the meat is under section 5.169, uses permitted subject to special approval. And I would like to just go through these items quickly, and then I'd be happy to answer any questions that the council may have. So under, if these were regulated as special approval under the general business district, which is B3, first looking at alternative financial services, we're recommending that they're subject to the following conditions. One, they cannot be located any nearer than 1,000 feet to another alternative financial service or another pawn shop. Secondly, they cannot be located any nearer than 500 feet to any residential zoning district, school, religious institution, park, or child care facility. And I have a map I'd like to put up. The map indicates is that it shows existing locations for alternative financial services, which there are 14, and then taking into account the 1,000-foot separation from other existing or future AFSs, as well as 500 feet to residential zoning districts. That limits to 26 potential parcels within the city that are left for consideration. But once you apply the standards themselves, it limits it to a maximum of 5 new sites. The existing sites would be regulated as legal non-conforming.
Excuse me. I don't mean to interrupt you, but could you move that thing
over? Yes, I'm sorry.
Please?
Can you tell us where the green dots
yes.
are? It's kind of hard to see.
Sure.
Do you want the
yeah, I was
light
trying
on?
To get the
lights
on.
It's the rheostat. It's the light now.
There you go.
green squares with the check mark. And you can't see. I'm sorry. Yes. Okay. There's Elite Finance, which is located at 18236 West 10 Mile Road. Cash Giant, which is located at 19771 West 12 Mile Road. American General Finance, which is located at 19791 West 12 Mile Road. Advance America has three stores, one at West 8 Mile, one at Telegraph, and one at Greenfield. Quick Money is located on Telegraph Road. Elite Finance is located on Southfield Road. Premier Mortgage Funding is located at West 9 Mile Road. Advance America has a fourth store at West 12 Mile Road. Cash in Hand is located at West 8 Mile Road. Check and Go is located on Southfield Road. And Check Advance is located on Southfield Road. So we have them on Southfield here and here. There's two located adjacent to each other. There's two located here. West 12 Mile and Losser over here on Greenfield. 8 Mile. There's two on Telegraph, one on West 9 Mile, and then one at 12 Mile. One at 12 Mile. And the other green parcels are the potential. Those are B3 district, potential sites and locations. So again, just to reiterate, with a 1,000-foot separation from each other and a 500-foot separation, there's 26 potential sites with a maximum of 5. If you apply all the standards, 5 future sites that could be considered. Again, they would have to be allowed by the property owner and conform with other requirements. And those other requirements include limiting the hours of operation from 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. Drive-through transactions would be prohibited. The petitioners to implement the recommendations made by the Southfield Police Department's Crime Prevention Bureau regarding site security. And we wanted to exempt retailers that use this as an accessory use only. For example, Myers or Kroger's might have check cashing as a convenience to their patrons and only takes up a very small portion of their store. So we're exempting establishments where less than 10% of the usable floor area is dedicated for these types of services.
Party stores included?
Well, party stores, if they meet that requirement. If they meet less than 10%, check cashing of the party store would be exempt. And we did some research on the types of fees that are being charged. And typically, the larger retail establishments such as Kroger's and Meijer's are only charging a nominal fee of $2-3 per check cashed. But the pure check cashing facilities are charging anywhere from 2-4% of the entire paycheck as a fee for cashing those checks. And so it's clear that there's a distinction between those types of businesses and the ones that are offering it as an accessory use. So again, our recommendation for your consideration is to put some regulations on the books, to do it as a special approval. That would also trigger a public hearing, would notify all the property owners within 300 feet, and require public hearing before City Council with a set of standards that you could either approve or deny the request. Currently, we have no standards other than if it's a retail district, they could go in there. Is there any questions on this before we go to pawn shops? Yes, ma'am.
This is for check cash.
Yes.
I was a witness last week. The check cashing one on Southfield Road in the shopping center. Another one I talked about.
Mm-hmm.
I stood there on my car and I saw a black young lady with a little 3-year-old, a 4-year-old walk in, and I was interested enough just to watch and see what would happen. I came out about 5 minutes later crying. Now, I can surmise why she was crying. She couldn't get a check cashed, or they cashed her check and took cash her check for the payment. That's what's happening. They're overcharging. Is there any way to stop that? Any way to regulate the amount of interest they can charge?
The best, from our research, the regulation of specifically how much they charge should come through the states. But where this, the local has control is through zoning. And to reduce the amount of these and to put some reasonable limitations, the research says that the local communities have the strongest way to do this through zoning. But as far as regulating these businesses and what they charge, they're suggesting that should come from the state or federal level.
Well, the cans are all there yet.
There's a state usury statute, and they have various rates, but the maximum that can be charged as interest on some kind of debt or is 25%. So that sets a pretty high ceiling.
And there's another outfit coming to us for tax abatement. An automotive lending company that charges 25 to 35 to the used car dealers to be able to sell used cars to the impoverished people at 25 to 30% interest. Soon we'll have it. Yeah.
Well, anyway, because in my opinion, I think we have enough of these facilities already in the South. Can we increase the number of feet that they are next to each other to put us at a maximum capacity?
Good question, Ms. Jordan. The Planning Commission did review maximum and minimums that other communities throughout the nation, and we chose to go with the maximum that was typically found. Larger communities like Detroit's, Chicago's, New York City's, have provided a greater separation, but it was based more on population size. And that our standards, as probably the city attorney will attest, it has to meet the reasonable test. And we feel that this is the maximum level at a reasonable amount, considering what other jurisdictions throughout the state and in the country. Certainly, we could try to exceed that. But the Planning Commission went through this. We looked as little as 200 feet up to a maximum of 1,000 feet separation, 200 feet up to a maximum of 500 from residential, and found that we can still limit these without completely excluding them. Once we start adding the additional distances, we probably would knock that five potential down to none, and then I don't know if we could use a reasonable test, but again, I would defer to the city attorney. We feel that these standards are as strong as they could be, and still meet the reasonable test.
I'd just like to push the envelope just a little bit further. I mean, even if we only increase it by 500 feet, I think there is enough of these businesses already in the city of Southfield. And to say that we have room for four more, I think it's too much. So I would be willing, and I would defer to the city attorney, to see if we can stretch it a little bit further to limit any more of these businesses.
We certainly can use our GIS analysis to see if...
Obviously, that is the problem. If you, by, you know, making the distance so great that you, in essence, expand that particular use, that's not a reasonable zoning restriction. So, within reason, we can look at that and see if 1,000 is the appropriate number. Thank you.
Well, just along that line, can we continue the moratorium on these?
We could extend that moratorium if we come up against the August date, absolutely.
I mean, that's another, it's not a great thing because you have to keep extending a moratorium, but...
Well, remember, even with the moratorium, if you use the moratorium essentially to ban the use, that's a problem. But we just enacted it. I'm sure that one extension would not be an unreasonable act on our part if we needed to look at that. But
yeah,
we do have two more months.
Right. We wanted to bring it to you early enough so that we have enough time to study, come back with some of your recommendations prior to enacting anything.
We really needed data, and you provided that. So I appreciate that. I was just thinking, I agree with Ms. Jordan. I think what we had is enough, and not only that, the ones we have, then we have them across the street, for instance, on Greenfield.
Oak Park.
So there's quite a few around us. So I would support, even if it, you know, ultimately we
we settle on the standards that you suggested, I'd support continuing the moratorium.
Well, do we need to get closer to that date to do that?
Well, the moratorium was established for us to study the issue and come up with, so if we at that point have not completed the study and we're still working on it, we would extend that moratorium.
So if, just with the timing through the chair, we would want to, if we need to extend it for further study, we would want to do that at the July 30th meeting.
Yeah.
That would be right.
And we can come back prior to that at least with the consideration of the 1,500 foot separation and see what that does and go from there.
Yes, what you talked about so far are check cashing, but there's also payday loans. Was that
that's included?
That's included
in the definition. Yes.
Okay. The second piece is there are some that are already established.
That's
if
correct.
They violate the rules that we eventually come up with, are they going to be grandfathered?
Well, they would be considered grandfathered. The building official would need to document them in existence prior to the establishment. They become legal non-conforming uses. However, there is a provision in the zoning ordinance. Should they ever be closed for a certain 6-month or 12-month period, or if they're damaged through fire, wind, or other natural disaster at greater than 50% of their value, in order to come back, they would have to comply with these standards. So in theory, they might be grandfathered for some period, but over time, they would be phased out if there was any changes I had indicated.
It could be phased out.
Could be.
Yeah, I know that you may have grabbed those numbers out of the air about 6 months or a year. Or
it's somewhere between 6 and 12 months.
That seems like a long time because if they're as productive as they probably are, they're not going to stay closed that long. Is there a rule that we can put in if they change ownership that we could cause it not to be grandfathered?
No, because they would, as a legal non-conforming use, they would have the right to sell that business. They would have the right to sell it because they came in and they had a legal, lawful use prior to this zoning amendment coming through and making them be out of sync with the ordinance. So, again, abandonment of the structure or, you know, damage to the structure so that it closes, and it's, but just to sell it, generally, no. No. They're able to sell it.
No. Okay. Maybe we can encourage somebody that's not a very good shot with some fireworks. To
we'll look at that as well when we go back through. We'll just see what other jurisdictions have done.
Okay, same.
Yeah.
Yeah, I understand that some of it, we're talking about, you know, some of the actual establishment of the building can be grandfathered, but what about the hours of operation? Is it, would that be subject to change? Because that's kind of more of a fluid thing.
Is your question, would these hours, if this was passed in this forum, would a
the
existing...
One, exactly.
No, because they would have, again, preceded, their use would have preceded.
So they could have the only late night operation.
I would like a list of the ones that we have, and if you could, like, release that to a map or something like that.
Yes.
And get a list of where they are and then number those things, so that if we want to look for them, we can.
Sure, I'll have that in your next packet.
Okay,
I have one other question. Carrie, can we limit the days of the week if those are open, or is that not possible?
Well, like, again, anything's possible as to whether or not we can uphold it, and it's the fairness, reasonableness test, and if we don't regulate other retail uses, I think it would be difficult to do that.
All right.
No, when you're ready, I'll go on to Pawn.
Okay.
Yeah, I do have a quick question, and it's from something that Bishop Ma said. If we're suggesting close at 8 o'clock, but they're located in the strip mall, and the strip mall, or everybody else in the strip mall stays open till 9 o'clock, would that be onerous to them? Would they have an argument?
Well, I think at that point, from a zoning perspective, we're saying this type of business would be one that you feel would be different than another retail use. And so from, again, a police power standpoint, we would try to regulate that, even if it is an early hour, than, say, an adjoining retail use.
Okay. I just want to make sure that when we come up with our final decision, that's not something that we're going to spend an awful lot of time in court trying to defend.
And through the chair, I gave the example of many banks are only open from 9 to 5, although they might be in a center with other retailers that are open till 9 or 11 p.m.
Yeah. But it's by their choice.
Right.
Not by ordinance that they have to close
right.
by. And we're telling them they
but
do have
we
to close.
But we do regulate special, there's certain special approvals that we do regulate some of the late night fast food restaurants. We could put hours, reasonable hours of operation on
okay.
Through the chair, if I could go to the next item.
Are we done with this Pawnshop tonight?
No. We haven't done Pawnshop yet.
I'd like to go on to Pawnshops if you're,
oh,
if the council's
right.
ready.
Go ahead.
Did we need a consensus that we're approving so that he can keep moving on what he's just presented?
Well, I do have some direction about looking at the further setbacks, and I will be prepared to come back to the council. I will also prepare a handout with the list of the existing businesses for your review prior to me coming back, and a map. Other than that, if there's any other direction that the council would like to give us.
But you're looking for our input so that you can then go to the planning commission and work out these details.
Well. What I'm looking for is the Planning Commission made this initial recommendation, and we're here to gather some input from the council, and then I will revise these and bring it back to the council for further consideration.
Okay, that's what I come to do. Okay, anyone else before we go on to the...
So I'm assuming that pretty much we're supportive, other than the things we've asked for, of the alternative financial services recommendations, page 2.
Well, I think we've heard you said the time, and we've kind of pushed it as far as we can.
Yeah.
So,
but we're still going to look at.
We are going to look at.
Right. The other thing is,
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. So we're
just
saying move ahead with
looking. Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
So
the next
part of this is review of pawn shops. Currently, there are 4 existing pawn shops: Blue Silver Diamond Broker, which is located on West 9 Mile Road; Matt's Jewelry Brokers, which is located on the West 10 Mile Road; Norman's Jewelry, which is located on Telegraph Road; and Ziegman's Jewelry and Loan, which is located on Evergreen Road. And those are indicated by the 4.
The other end.
Those are indicated by the 4 blue diamonds.
What's the one on Telegraph?
Telegraph Road is Telegraph here.
Norman's.
Okay. And again, applying the standards of 1,000-foot separation from other pawn shops and AFS services, and 500 feet from residential zoning district, school, religious institution, park, child care facility, and we also included firearm dealer and businesses selling alcohol. It limits potentially to 20 sites. We're located up here on the northwest portion of the city, and there's a couple down here. 20 initial eligible sites that would be reduced to a maximum of 4 potential new sites given these standards. The hours of operation, we recommend again 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. Also requires unobstructed view of the business from a public street, a security plan. Window bars, chains, etc. are prohibited, and other approved operating and development standards. At least 30% of a first floor facade that faces a public street shall be windows or doors of clear or lightly tinted glass that allow views into the building at eye level. The business windows shall not be obscured in any way, including by temporary or painted window signs. The petitioner is to implement the recommendations made by the Southfield Police Department's Crime Prevention Bureau regarding site security. All receipt, sorting, or processing of goods shall occur within a completely enclosed building, and the building shall have lighting to provide illumination for security and safety of parking and access areas. We worked closely with community policing on coming up with these standards. They had additional recommendations that we felt should be on a case-by-case basis, so we're not locking ourselves in should technology change for security purposes. But we feel due to the types of businesses and the unintended consequences that these businesses can bring, that the additional security was warranted.
Terry, on the thing with the including temporary or painted window signs, you know, a lot of our gas stations, because we prohibited paper signs, they went to neon signs. We have a lot of gas stations that are just loaded with neon.
Right.
So don't you think you ought to include that as well, being obscured? I think this is a little narrow, the temporary or painted window signs.
Okay, that's a good point. And again, the purpose was to make sure that we had clear, the police department had
exactly.
clear vision in. And
I
appreciate you bringing it.
I
appreciate you bringing that up because no one had brought that up previously. And I know that you know, a couple of weeks ago, the building department made some recommendations with regard to sign ordinance. And when you do consider the sign ordinance, we might want to roll in some of these suggestions for other types of businesses. But at least we, because of security issues, we felt we could control the interior signage on windows specifically through the special approval process.
My comment is the same again, pushing the envelope on 1,000 feet from another pawn shop. I think that has to be even further because you're saying we currently have 4 pawn shops.
That's
in
correct.
The city, and based upon this requirement, that would allow 20 more?
No, there's 20 potential sites that would qualify as B3 businesses, but if you included these setback standards, only 4, a maximum of 4 would be permitted.
So we're at our capacity now.
Those are good suggestions, and we'll look at the setbacks and see if it meets the reasonable test working with the legal department.
All right, thank you.
Anyone else?
I don't know if you can do this or not, but when you do the maps, is it possible to show the ones that are really close to Southfield, but maybe in adjacent cities like Oak Park? And there's one that used to be where it used to be an old Radio Shack store down on 8 Mile and Grand River.
We will try.
This will
require field work, mm-hmm. Whereas we have a database with existing businesses within the city. So we will do our best to identify those. Do you want the ones immediately adjacent to like our boundaries?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
That makes sense. That's a good idea, Mr. Fisher.
Very good.
We should be able to regulate that, even if it's not in our community. It'd be so many feet on any other one along our boundaries. Yeah, no matter where they are. Okay.
You know, I brought this forward because by charter, the application, once they meet the regulations for police clearance, it comes to the mayor's office for approval, and there was nothing to regulate any of this. So this would go into place, and what would the process be? Because right now, the application submitted, it is sent to the police department to check off, then it comes to the mayor's office. So we need to make sure we have a process, because the clerk's office scores it. So we got to make sure that So would it come before the site plan or planning?
I would say, and correct me if I'm wrong, you would receive the application from the clerk, and then you would pass it to the planning commission and the council for review before it goes back.
It could occur a couple of different ways, but by state law, on their application, they have to identify the specific site wherein they want to conduct the business. So So if you didn't have something from the council, a resolution,
no, that's not my point.
Okay.
What is the process going to be? So does it go to the police first, the planning first, before it comes to me? Because right now it's submitted usually, and sometimes it's
well,
my office.
Well, we can just add a routing.
It
should go really, it should go to planning first. Because if they don't get special use approval, they can't locate at that location, so there's no need to. Right, so if you don't want to add that to your process,
we can add it to the routing.
No, we can add it to the routing.
The process will be to go to the planning department first. Planning department will have a form to sign off, then it will go to police.
Right, once a special use is approved by council, then it could go to police for the background.
It's not a special use, though.
Yes, we're taking it as a special use in B3.
Okay.
That's the proposal. So it would have to, it would initiate in planning for the special use. It would go through planning commission, go through council. And then if they approve the special use, that'd be the first step, and then it could go on as our normal process. Background check from police, and then your office in terms of issuing a license at that for that location.
If they meet the requirements, doesn't that fall under the planners? They just look at it just like the police. Right now, they just look at the criteria, they do their background check, and then it's processed. Because what you're doing is also tying it up, and what is going to be asked for? Because if you're doing a planning, site plan, you need to have architecture drawings, and you're adding a lot to the process.
What?
If you take it through there, where the planner, if it's a designated spot, and this is designed, then the planner signs off that it met that criteria.
But that's not what the planner is proposing. He's proposing to take this, any pawn shop would be a special use in a B3. That's the only place it could be, and it would only be a special use. So that would go through the special use process. And if council denied the special use, then there would be no need for it to come to you at that location because they wouldn't have the zoning approval.
And if I could, we currently require freestanding drive-through restaurants to go through a special approval with a lot less of negative impact. And the other reason that I recommend special approval is it gives that public hearing process. So we would notify neighbors, adjacent properties, owners within 300 feet, discover if there's any other issues, and that can all be taken into consideration in the process. Whereas, as you've indicated right now, it's just you, as mayor, sign off without anything other than the police department's check. And there's no checks and balances to make sure that they're meeting other requirements of the city.
And that was my concern when I brought it forward. I just don't know why it's special use. I think it should go through the planning department. This is special use, but I like the process. Why would it have to be a special use? Why couldn't it just be required to go through the planning process?
Again, our recommendation is the special use then triggers public hearing and gives the
residents
an opportunity to weigh in
at least
two times.
But
not
you get that with planning site review.
A site plan does not trigger that. Only special approval or
only
zoning amendment.
Okay. I like that. I like the public hearing.
There's specific requirements, and then there's general standards that the city looks at when considering special approval.
Yeah, I'm just curious if we've had a chance to discuss perhaps concrete next steps. I mean, are we going to try and beat this 180-day moratorium expiration, or are we going to kind of
through the chair, my goal would be to come back at one of your July COW meetings, and then prior to the expiration of the moratorium, if the council is comfortable, they could direct us to go to a public hearing. If they're not, then prior to the expiration of the moratorium, we would request an extension for further study.
So we'll probably hear from you again on this in July, and then see if we're comfortable with where it's at.
That's correct.
Okay.
Okay.
I'm just going to put this on the table. According to the law, most of the time when you do that, you direct the council. The council directs, but it's like a contract. The language on this should be different because this is approving it so that it can be signed. And
the charter is clear on. There's a few powers that belong to the mayor, often, whoever the mayor is. And so
I
the
don't
language,
understand
what you're
saying.
That's okay. It is directing, it is approving it for the signature of the mayor. So it's not directing the mayor, because I can still not sign.
Okay. Well, we'll work
you
with the city attorney.
You would simply be approving that location.
You're right. That's
and
right.
Then you would approve whether to grant this individual
right.
Can it be a recommendation?
Right. I just want to be clear, because everyone doesn't understand that, because mm-hmm. normal process is that you direct, because the language will say you direct the council, the mayor, and the clerk to sign. That's all.
Okay.
Yeah,
we'll think
it's
a good process. That's a good process.
Ready, Terry?
Unless there's any other questions.
It's not directly to Terry. It's just a statement that I'd like to make. When we make decisions, theoretically, we make decisions to make the community better. We're looking forward to making this decision. And there's a portion of this community that uses these alternative finance services that if we restrict them, it will limit the number. And I think that's good. But I think there's something else that we might want to do, and that is investigate the National League of Cities program on Bank On, which is education portion. It's an education program for people that do not have bank accounts or have very small bank accounts for whatever reason, and it encourages banks to get involved in this, to work with these folks to start bank accounts and become more independent, so they don't have to use these alternative financial services. And I'd like us to take a look at that so that when we restrict these, and we will, I think we will anyhow, there's an alternative that the folks that would normally go to these can go to make themselves more self-sustaining and save money. And there's some data that says for folks that use payday loans, if they miss paying off the check, and we were talking about like a $300 or a $350 check, if they miss paying it off 8 times, it costs them over a lifetime about $40,000 because of the interest that gets charged for not paying off it. And to me, if we're really doing our job, we ought to try to make life better for people.
Well, we've given the information.
Pardon?
At least give them the information.
Give them the option. Right. You know, it's very similar to how we're working with people with that are facing foreclosure or anything else. I think we have two roles. One is to make rules that make the life better, but there are also some options that for those people that get caught in the trap can work their way out of it.
Would you recommend doing some kind of a series, like in the library or something?
Yeah,
or
but first of all, we need to find out what Bank On is all about, and get the details and find out how we go about using them. How about setting that up?
Do you
want
to release something to find
sure.
out?
Sure.
Sure.
I
based on what you said about you said a lot of people, some people need this.
Yes.
I think when you're on the map, I would like to see it in certain sections so people don't have to go from one end of the city down to, say, 8 Mile and Greenfield.
Yeah.
You know, not I don't want to proliferate them, but I would like to have them in what would be logical locations for those people that really need them. But not certain
yeah.
people, we don't want one in every street corner.
That's right.
So well, can anybody look at that and think it'd be great?
Okay.
While they're setting up, I just wanted to concur.
but I didn't realize the bank actually banned some people from opening accounts if they have some bad practices. And it's not just their bank, it's all banks. They will ban you. And then there are some people who just don't put money in the bank, they just cash. And yes, people do that. Credit union won't let me know. It's really sad. Well, some of it, you have, I don't know what it is, but some kind of bad banking practice, they will ban you from opening an account.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. The next item on your agenda is a discussion on the second modification to the Bassett Building Company consent judgment. The piece of property that we're here to discuss tonight is part of the New Orleans Mall Complex, corner of 10 Mile and Greenfield. Specifically, we're speaking about the existing building that faces 10 Mile Road. It's approximately 14,400 square foot building. What I would like to do, though, is because this is a modification of the consent judgment, I would at least like to run through the history of the consent judgment. The first consent judgment, the original decree is from 1962 and dealt with a number of properties along 10 Mile Road, those being the properties here in red, lots 2 through 13. Under that original decree, lots 2 through 5, those would be the four lots on the west side, could be used for residential use. The remaining lots 6 through 13, were allowed to be used for ERO uses, Education Research Office. In addition, that original decree also set front and rear yard setbacks, as well as structure height for any buildings that were constructed on the property. We moved to 1987, and that is the first modification of the consent judgment. That modification dealt specifically with the east 18 feet of lot 9 and then lots 10 through 13. Under that modification, what was approved were uses within the B1 neighborhood business district with two exceptions, those being any restaurants of any kind as well as adult bookstores. Now we move to what is being proposed, and that's the second modification to the consent judgment. Again, this deals with the same properties that the first modification did, that is the east 18 feet of lot 9 and then lots 10 through 13. In this case, what the modification is proposed to permit, and I'll read it, is religious institutions of any type for the regular assembly of persons, the conducting of religious services, and accessory buildings or uses customarily incidental to such use, including but not limited to religious education classes and administrative offices of such size and character that will be in harmony with permitted uses under Section 5.103, Article 9, Office Service District. In addition, they did retain the exceptions for the restaurants and the adult bookstores. Again, those would not be allowed on these particular properties. Those are from the first modification. And again, did set minimum yard setbacks. As I noted earlier, this is an elevation of the existing building. It is a 14,000 square foot building. The proposal is to take up 10,600 square feet for a sanctuary and a social hall, and then retain the additional 3,800 square feet for the addition for the existing retail uses that are currently there. Planning Commission did hear this a month ago and did present a favorable recommendation to council. This project has been before the Council Site Plan Committee on two occasions. The first occasion, a number of concerns were raised by the committee, those being number one, use of the retail center for religious type purpose. The second item, retaining the retail uses in the same building as the retail, as the religious institution. And then the last item being the exterior of the building, making it look more like a religious use instead of the existing facade that is more representative of a retail type use. At the second meeting of the Council Site Plan Committee, again, the petitioner did come back after direction was provided by the committee. They did come back with a new elevation for the building.
That does include covering up some of the windows, and I can allow the architect to deal with this in a few minutes. But did come back with blocking some of the windows with particular panels, and again, allowing some additional architectural treatments above some of the doors, as well as a portico to go underneath for protection for those who would be using the facility. The committee did express the same concerns that they did at the first meeting, again, with regard to the strip center for religious purposes, the retail uses in the same building, and obviously were more favorable for the exterior that was shown here. Mr. Neil Single is here representing the congregation, and what I'd like to do is turn it over to him at this time for the presentation.
Hi, my name is Neil Single. I live at 17365 Shorefield Place in Southfield. First of all, I wanted to thank you for allowing us to come back and to present in front of the entire council and to explain what we are proposing. But before I do that, as I walked in to this room, it's my first time here, first time inside this room, I sat down, I happened to glance at the wall over here, and I happened to notice some of the strategic plan goals of the city of Southfield, and I couldn't help but notice that a lot of the items that you notice here, I mean, you've probably seen this tens, if not hundreds of times, but a lot of the things that are here right on the board as for the city plan goals, I think are pretty much in line with what we're trying to do with this piece of land and for our community. Take you back, just to give you a little bit of history, I'm representing the Congregation of Abba Solem, and Congregation of Abba Solem, or Abba Solem Torah Center, started probably about six to seven years ago. We started out in a basement in Oak Park. And let me give a little bit of history of what happens a lot with sometimes inside the Orthodox community when synagogues get to a certain point, they sort of branch out. They, you know, so they break off. There's different, not necessarily different views, but there's another congregation that sort of forms and starts off. So that's what we did. We wanted something, a learning center that was geared towards the young working families. There are a lot of professionals, a lot of people that are very well educated with inside the group that wanted to have a place for a religious aspect. They worked the entire day and they wanted to have classes in the evening. They wanted to have some camaraderie on the weekends with services and to have a spiritual guidance. So we start off inside this basement, and within a short period of time, we outgrew that basement, you know, very quickly. We then moved to a modified 1,500 square foot residence in Oak Park, and 5 years later, about right now, we're bursting from the seams, about 70 to 75 members of families at this point in time. So we began the search to look for a permanent home for ourselves. And there was an extensive search that, you know, that looked towards Huntington Woods, it looked towards areas in Oak Park, and it looked towards areas in Southfield. I was in charge of the commission to find the best place to find in Southfield. To give you a little bit of background of the Orthodox community, there are about 50% of the Jewish Orthodox community live inside Southfield, and 50% live in Oak Park. However, only about 25% of all synagogues are in Southfield versus 75% in Oak Park. And if you're not familiar with Orthodox Jews, we're required to walk to synagogue on Saturdays and holidays. And, you know, the longer the walk, it becomes pretty cumbersome for myself, and I hear it from my wife, and the kids as well don't want to show up, and that's not good for a family. So what we wanted to do was bring something closer to home, something, a place that we could call home here in Southfield, because if you looked at most of the congregants that we had, they're mainly inside Southfield. I live on pretty close to Southfield Road, just north of 10 Mile Road. I moved in 7 years ago, and I can't tell you how many more families have moved in since that point in time. I know that foreclosures within the city, there's about 1,400 foreclosures or so that are going on right now, and there's a lot of homes up for sale. But I look around the Orthodox community, and I can't really find one house for sale. People are knocking door to door trying to find homes. And I think that's one of the only parts of the, I mean, one of the only parts of the community that the supply, that the demand is pretty much outdoing the supply, which is causing property, you know, property values to go up in that area. So we were looking throughout the entire 10-mile Greenfield area, because we didn't want to isolate or alienate the people in Oak Park. We wanted to keep them on as well as members, but we wanted to add more people from Southfield and get more people from Southfield a place to call home right there in their backyard. We looked up and down. We pretty much tackled every building possible. We put in offers on two places. One was accepted, but then was rejected. We looked at every, I'm telling you, we looked at every office building possible that would suit our needs. And then, probably 6 months after we started looking, this piece of property came up. I happened to give the owner a phone call and asked him if he wanted to sit down and have a conversation. And it leads us to today, where we're in a contract to purchase this piece of land. Now, this piece of land is the perfect location for us for many, many, many reasons. Number one, it's because of the area. It's one of the only areas that we have the opportunity to occupy within the 10-mile Southfield area. And number two, it is on one level. We don't have to modify it that much in terms of having, to make it handicap accessible. It's a lot easier. It's a lot bigger of a piece of property, 14,490 square feet to be exact. So this, along with many other reasons, led us to believe that this was the location that we wanted for ourselves. Now, we're a, relatively speaking, when you look at other congregations, we're relatively young, and we do foresee ourselves growing to a certain extent in the future. However, 14,490 square feet is a lot for us to occupy at this time. And quite frankly, talking about right here, when talking about where we have to have financially sound and sustainable city government, I think we have to be financially sound ourselves and thinking that we want to occupy. We're taking a big chunk to go ahead and to purchase this piece of property because we do believe that this is the perfect place for us. But on the other hand, it comes down to cash also. It comes down to be fiscally responsible. We have to be fiscally responsible. I think the council knows that everybody's running into difficulties in terms of money these days, and we have to take that obligation upon us to be more sensitive. So therefore, having these three locations on the eastern side of the building is very important to us, because it is going to offset the income that we're going to take in, is going to offset a lot of our expenses that we have. And we've gone through a proposal like this to modify the entire building, or even earlier was suggested that we modify perhaps just one side of the building. And this illustration here, I don't know if you can put this up, and just to remember that this brown is really the color of the brick also. So this is a concept of what we could do as well, is keeping the existing side. Imagine these things matching and aesthetically looking very nice. But on the other hand, having the ability either to make it like one building, so it looks like one building, and you occupy three places at the end with these retail shops, or to modify three quarters of the building. And just to say, as people are walking, because the concern was a lot also is that we don't want to have the impression of having a storefront church or synagogue. This would give the idea of having one side completely redone, the other quarter of the building is staying in its existing form, but it's two buildings sort of attached at the hip, but to make it look like two separate buildings to avoid that issue. So we would be okay with going with either one of these concepts, either redoing the entire front or modifying part of the building. We see for the council's advice on this.
Madam Chair. discuss the request of the synagogue on this site. It was before the site plan committee, and my biggest objection, not to the synagogue, but was to make it look like a synagogue, and that it not be a storefront situation. I have no objection to the one that is on your left. I've never seen the one to your right before. That didn't come before us.
No, this is yeah. Something that we brought
and,
today.
But in looking at the one to your right, I guess I have to see more. Why is it that the entire synagogue, the color of the brick? You know, I just went back over there the other day, and I'm looking at it, and I'm looking at your drawing, and I said, is it wood? What is the building facade, the ground?
Well,
is that wood, or is that going to be the brick?
Well, if I can quickly explain, the top part of the building, so this is the brick, as you can see inside here.
Well, yeah, but
this
I'm talking about the color.
Correct. This color is this color.
What?
Okay, you have to imagine this color being this color.
Okay, well, that's what's throwing me off.
Correct. It was a brownish color brick, but this brick was to continue throughout the entire top and panels.
Because looking at the area, if you're putting up a brown building, it looks like cabin up north somewhere. It doesn't fit in a neighborhood along 10 Mile Road.
I would agree with you on that. So
the idea
is to match the two sides in terms of aesthetics.
I still feel that something has to be tied to sooner or later, even if you need the retail for revenue presently. There has to be something in here that eventually will eliminate it. The retail. In other words, there are short leases. One is not a lease. I mean, you might tell. And I might add that my thought at the site plan meeting was that we all discussed that we could not come up with a solution other than the fact that I think we had, I guess no one except Mr. Lance was for the synagogue having retail. And so I thought, you know, from the site plan time to now I would say, well, let's compromise the thing and say, okay, because I understand you said one lease is up.
Well, Jimmy, just to be clear,
why don't you
give it all.
That's why we're all here this evening looking
absolutely.
At it. And I thought it should come before the full council for letting them discuss what its impact is going to be on that neighborhood. And that might bring you to the strategic plan goals number 3 there, where it says quality development and redevelopment.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
I agree with
and
you.
So that's where I'm coming from.
So let me explain to you exactly in terms of tenant-wise. Right now there are 4 people in here. There's Fashion International, there's Henry the Hatter, there's the Scarf Box, and then there's, I'm not quite sure what the next, what the name of it, but there's a retail, I think it's a men's clothing store inside here. Fashion International and Henry the Hatter have been landmarks in the city of Southfield for, you know, over a decade. And a lot of people are big fans of them. The Scarf Box moved in. They are currently right now month to month, but we want to lock them in for a longer term lease. The Scarf Box here and this other establishment have just entered into a little bit longer term contracts, 5-year and a 3-year, I believe, or maybe a 5-year and a 5-year. However, both these places are not paying their lease, and there is I believe there's a motion to, Paul, what's status of it right now, but there's a motion.
We had judgments, but we're working with them.
We're working with them to, you know, to evict them, and to have, well, at least one of these, this tenant right here, you want to evict because they're not paying the rent, and take over up until this mark, and we want to keep.
Do you want to leave Henry the Hatter there and that, and extend the lease?
We want to keep Fashion International, keep Henry the Hatter, keep the Scarf Box, or they're not going to be in there, fill it with somebody else in there, and take over the entire building, the rest of the building. 10,600.
That's how we said it,
the
site plan.
Well, it's the same plan.
Well, it's the same plan, but what you're saying is that they have short leases, and at the time that the leases, that they would not be renewed. And now you're talking about me.
I mean, our goal always was to keep those as tenants. Again,
now it's a shopping center with a synagogue.
Right
and
now.
Instead of a synagogue.
So I think if that's your concern, this really addresses that, in the fact that we have one part of the building. Visually, when you go down that building, it's not going to look like a shopping center.
Well,
it's going to look like a synagogue, and right next door, it's going to look like there's a shopping center. They happen to be connected at the hip, but visually, they look like two entire buildings, two separate buildings, because the design is totally different between the two. And that's what gives it sort of that separation.
Well, you and I have a difference in that I think that that there's no way, if you keep the center with commercial, that is going to have a religious symbolic look of that block. It's going to look like, and as I expressed at the meeting, site plan, that, you know, in declining urban centers, you have churches that move into shopping centers, into storefronts. And I didn't want that to be seen as a church moving into a storefront. And I thought that when you were expressing the long-range program would be that those leases there would expire and be relocated somewhere else, and that you would expand into a learning center and a synagogue.
I think you're correct in that sense. Our long-term vision is that could be 2 years or 3 years or 5 years from now, that we do grow into this, and we eventually, our goal is to take over the entire building, 100%. I apologize if it wasn't clear on that. Our intention is to take over the entire building. Fiscally, right now, we think this is doable. And
I thought you understood what I
was
getting at. Matter of fact, the minutes of the site plan reflect it. And I guess that one I've never seen before. And that one that Seymour has on his, by him, you know, I think it takes away the shopping center look. However, when you put, I mean, that doesn't look like two separate buildings.
Which one? This one here? Correct. And this goes back to a recommendation that we had inside that meeting from Mr. Lance, who suggested that we have to have it with the appearance of having two separate. And that was back when we first started discussing it.
I've never seen that before.
Right. This is a new drawing that we drew up. Based upon
prior to our meeting?
Prior to this meeting.
Oh, prior to
prior
this,
to this meeting today. So we can show the idea that we threw around this idea inside that study session.
Yeah, that actually is absolutely the opposite of what we were trying to do in our meeting. And that was to make it look like a religious facility, a synagogue, with the expansion of a learning center, and that it not be looking like a storefront church or synagogue. And that looks more like what we were trying to get away from than the one to my left. But, you know, that was my impression. Synagogue, buying the property, becoming a synagogue, God bless you, that's a great location, and wish you the best. But I just, I could never vote against, a church or synagogue, but, it does not look like quality development as I see it, and redevelopment in the city. And I'm sorry that it does not.
Mr. Simon?
I have a contrary view on this. I think you're in transition. I believe that you will continue to grow. I mean, all the indicators, and I'm very familiar with the neighborhood, are that we're seeing an increase in Orthodox families. I know that housing is scarce there, or quickly turns over when it does. And I do believe you'll grow. And I understand your need, while you're growing, to keep the businesses you have. I would hate to see Southfield lose both the two end businesses. I don't know the others, but I know both Fashion International and the Hatter. And I'd hate to see them move from Southfield perhaps down the road, 5 years down the road, when you need the space, then we can keep them here and find something in the area, or maybe in New Orleans Mall itself. But because the building has a little setback on that far end, to me it's logical that you make two distinct. One is part of New Orleans Mall, it's the shopping area, and the other is the synagogue. And eventually it becomes all a synagogue. So I favor the plan you brought tonight that we haven't seen. But you've got your until you are ready for that space, then it doesn't look like, it looks like two buildings side by side rather than, I really don't care for that. The dry on the left, if you're going to have Louis the Hatter in there and Fashion International, then it looks like you've got stores and a synagogue. This is clearly a demarcation, and I certainly want to see your synagogue in Southfield. So I would support this plan, keeping those businesses, and again, I have every reason to believe that you'll be successful.
Ken, I'd like to just say this to you. I just took a long week and trying to look at our city and driving in the Plymouth, Michigan, Northfield, Novi, which are communities which are gaining not only in population but in value, and seeing what is there that is different than what we have. And it's amazing that the new developments, and it's something I've always questioned Nick about, Nick, I always said that it couldn't happen, but you have several different types of buildings, commercial, offices, banks, that are all the same brick. I mean, it looks rich. It looks to be strong, well-developed, appeasing landscape, and it looks like there's value. And you come into Southfield, and it reminds me of when I was telling Nick it doesn't fit when they approved the cancer building across the street, which does not fit. And I just trying to get counsel and everyone who lives in this community to be aware that our home values are dropping drastically. Not only our home values, but our corporate office buildings. And until we give some kind of an idea of what the city should develop into and how it should develop, and like I said right here, quality development and redevelopment, then each parcel is going to be a problem piece. But it's got to fit. You'll have now three different bricks. You have the EFROs, the the restaurant, the gray brick, and
it's going to be the same brick. You just
I understand, but you have uses that are different. And I'm not against the synagogue.
No, I understand.
But I'm just saying to you, and it's you know, I mean, absolutely. Well, then that's why you're here, and not maybe somewhere else in Plymouth or Northville or somewhere else, because that is not desirable planning. All right? If you look at the richness of it, Ryback Road sometimes, back Plymouth Road. And I'm just trying to say that this city's got to come back and reevaluate how we develop all these parcels so there's some kind of look that expressed in our developments.
I don't think that you're going to accomplish that. I mean, your goal is lofty, but perhaps it's too late with all the building that we have. I don't think you're going to accomplish it on the back of this synagogue.
You're misusing what I'm saying. It's not on the back of the synagogue. The synagogue is not the question here. It's how it looks. How it looks into the area.
The synagogue
is
before us.
How it looks. No, it's not. It's redevelopment of a piece of property and a consent judgment.
You can argue that, but the truth is nobody else, both stores have been vacant for years. Nobody else is bidding to be in this shopping center.
But that's not the argument. That's not what I'm saying. I'm just saying is that it's got to all look pleasing to the area.
They can look pleasing.
Okay.
And it's a temporary it's a phase.
The petitioner knows I'm not going to vote against the synagogue. But I'm just trying to get to a point where everything on that corner starts looking the same, looks upbeat, looks attractive.
But it's not going to look like New Orleans Mall. It's not going to have an orange roof. It's not.
Then you're playing games because you're the one who always talks about Magnolia having having a wellness look, you know. And I'm just saying, if it's not Magnolia, that the rest of the city look is nice to.
If it's not Magnolia, it's something else you find fault with me on. I don't care, Don. You just made it personal. This is my two cents on this. I stand by what I'm saying.
Okay.
Yeah, I just have a few questions about the two designs. Does this one take into account that you're going to keep the hat and Fashion International?
In both the cases, we'd like to keep them.
So is there an ultimate goal, though, as you expand and become bigger, that you're ultimately getting the whole property as a synagogue in and of itself?
Absolutely.
Is it a fluid kind of transition from, on this plan, the free storefront into the synagogue, or is the synagogue, isn't it kind of even offset a little bit? It's not just one fluid strip.
You could see over here, you see where it comes out about 5 feet. So this would really give a nice demarcation between the two different sides.
So there's a demarcation that's already
built into it.
So then as you expand, should you want to take over those properties and expand the synagogue, you could transition more to that look. But as it stands in that plan right now, there's almost as if it is two different buildings anyway.
It's got the appearance of that 5 foot coming out when it was architecturally made.
Yeah, so just in my opinion, I think that having that transition, and if there is kind of a natural demarcation, that to me isn't necessarily a blight. On Southfield, I think it looks like it would be two different areas of business: the synagogue, which is clearly looks like a synagogue, and then a shopping area, and then eventually transition into that. I kind of can't understand how you would want to, you either the Hatter or Fashion International or a customer would understand that those two different entrances are completely something different. I think that would deter people from going into the hat shop and going into Fashion International until you were able to have the finances to make the whole building a synagogue. I'd rather actually see it kind of be two different separate entities, just for a consumer point of view and if there's a natural demarcation, I can see it jetting out, I'm okay, you know, with this plan as opposed to that one. So that's kind of my two cents on that.
Yeah. In the two renderings, this rendering looks like it has a flat roof. That has a pitched roof down to the point where it's the demarcation point, and then it's a flat roof. In reality, what are your plans? Flat roof or the pitched roof?
I think behind yours is a flat roof. This is a facade that's up on top too. Again, we wanted to make it look like it is a totally separate piece of property. And again, we're willing to work with the city in terms of, you know, aesthetics, how it should look. But our main goal inside this rendering was exactly that, to give it a different look, to give it some elevation here, to give it a different look when you're driving down with that demarcation to look like a separate building.
Okay, so the ultimate design would be, would you take the facade down to make it a flat roof, or would you extend the flat roof? When you take over the whole
building? Going forward?
Yeah.
It's a good question. I mean, I personally happen to like, this is probably less expensive longer term.
Mm-hmm.
We haven't discussed this or anything, but and it's probably from a engineering standpoint, maybe a little bit easier because of wind drifts and snow drifts and things on the inside. If you have those type of things, and maybe you have a cost savings if you're getting first to put it up. But you know, phase two, you know, we would take, you know, we could take recommendations from the city as well on that.
Yeah, one of the things is, and I don't know what kind of air conditioning or furnaces or anything they're in there right now, but one of the things is, if a lot of people, they put them on the roof, but then they have to put a facade up there to hide them. So I don't know if you intend to do that or not, but that pitched roof or the facade that looks like a pitched roof would serve that purpose. Now, the other thing that keeps me scratching my head is the rendering down here that's a blown-up photograph. The brick is that color. Everything else looks...
The brick is this color.
Yes.
Okay.
Is the whole thing going to be that color?
It's going to be that color, correct. We're going
to... Then why don't you tell your architect to get another pencil?
I mean, aesthetically, the point is, have some vision here, but the point is, yes, it is going to be the entire, you know, the same color brick. We're going to fix the exterior down on this side to make it look like clearly like it's a separate place.
What color are the panels?
This would match the brick, okay? It would match the brick. It would aesthetically, it would look pleasing to the eye.
Okay, now, the last question I have at this point in time is, you intend to grow, and in the transition period, you really would like to have the income to offset the cost of the whole project. There's, at some point in time, if you continue to grow, your income from your congregation is going to, at some point, make the crossover of what you're bringing in. Do you have any projection of when that is, so that maybe you can really think about asking the other retail center to thank you so much, but you're going to have to find it. You don't have to go home, but you can't stay here?
Correct. I mean, you know, we started initial talks with the landlord tenants to up the leases, and we wanted to really give ourselves a little bit of time, so we gave ourselves a five-year period. They wanted to have a five-year option on the other side. We declined that because we felt strongly within that five-year period we would be up to a position that we could take over the entire building, and that is our goal.
Well, based on the fact that the bulk of that building's been empty for well over 5 years. I'm pretty close to it anyhow. But when Mr. Allen's moved out and left that space empty, it's just been sitting there as an empty building. Now it's going to have some use. And I guess a transition period to make it a something that can be successful, that really doesn't look that bad to me. The demarcation point, especially if it's all going to be pretty much the same.
It's
the pitch roof that makes the difference to me.
Correct.
Thank you.
Mr. Cohen?
Yes.
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 Mr. Cohen? Johnson?
Yeah, if we, I know it was discussed at the site plan, the synagogue will go off the tax roll. How is the land to be divided since it's all one sibling?
Terry, if you want to.
If I could, through the chair, we did a little research with the city assessor. And the current building is 10,342.
14,490. Yeah. Through the chair, the property would be lot split. And the current building, which is approximately 14,000 square feet, generates approximately $10,372 in city taxes. The value of the storefronts that the applicant is recommending to keep is approximately 3,888 square feet, which translates into $2,790 in city revenue. And there would be a loss of $7,582 if that was to go for the non-profit status. One option for consideration, because this is a consent judgment, if the council is favorable in keeping the retail portion, is some type of payment to the city prorated based on the split square footage of approximately $2,800 to offset the cost of police and fire services until, and again, maybe the term sunset out, there's a five-year phasing out of the retail. So we did look at the tax that's generated proportionally on this property, which is about $10,300. And if it was split between what they like to occupy as the initial synagogue versus keeping the storefronts, it's about a 70-30% split. The other thing I could add is maybe what's troubling me about the keeping the storefront is that it's dated, and maybe there is some compromise. It can still look differently if that's the council's direction, but we could update the awnings and some other of the facades during this transition period. I think the thing that I look at is it's just the facade is very dated, and Mr. Mandel had an opportunity to go through all the materials on the proposed portion, but for me, I'm more inclined to have it updated. And if not look exactly the same, at least we could work with the applicant through the council on updating the facades and the storefronts in that five-year period.
Clearly expressed to you my concerns that they have not changed. But I did have a question. You indicated that you're required to walk for services, you're required to walk religious services on Saturday and Sunday.
No, Saturday, Friday night. Sunset through sunset.
So what happens if there's a religious service or there's an activity at the building other times? Are you allowed to drive your car?
That's a great question. Thank you. Most of the activities that take place, and you know, the reason why we thought this was a very good fit as well, is that this is not open, you know, 24/7. I mean, it's not open during really the daytime. The main hours of operation are the evenings and weekends. So it basically starts at 8:30 in the evenings, maybe to about 10:30 during the week, and the weekends, meaning Saturday alone. Is services throughout the course of the day. So the main time that we are going is going to be on Saturday, and that's when really all the walking is going to occur.
Well, my question was, do you drive your car outside of your normal religious services?
On Saturdays?
No. Do you drive your car Sunday through Friday? Can you drive your car to the
church? Sure.
And the sanctuary will hold 250.
Approximately 200-250.
What's the square footage, maybe the planners can help me, in terms of the required parking needed for 250 people? Is it about?
If I may, through the chair, I can address that. The parking was based upon, and within the zoning ordinance, it states one parking space for every three seats. So if we're looking at a capacity of 250 people,
divided by three comes to 83 parking spaces.
There are 83 parking spaces on the site.
There are 24 parking spaces on site. However, they wish to enter into a cross-access agreement for additional parking on the existing New Orleans Mall site.
That's one of the issues that I have, is that there's really not enough parking directly in front of this building to handle what the capacity of the sanctuary is. I'm just not comfortable with use of this basic building turning it into a emergency facility. I believe that the current consent judgment should stay the same. I'm not against your religion. I'm not against the Jewish people. I'm not that type of person at all. I'm a Christian person with Christian beliefs. I understand what you stand for, and I agree with what you stand for. However, I cannot support, in this instance, using this building, the shopping center for this building. And again, at the meeting, I stated, bring it to the entire council, because you have six other people that can vote in favor. But I cannot, in good standing, vote in favor of this, thinking about not only the future facilities, but the future facilities. Well, I'm thinking about the city long term, and I don't think it's the best choice for that.
Anyone else?
Yeah, one of the things is that we're really kind of overlooking is, and he brought it up when he made his presentation, the adjacent neighborhoods are within the walking distance of the synagogue. And we have neighborhoods throughout the community that have empty homes in them. As this congregation grows, they'll be looking for homes in the surrounding neighborhoods within walking distance. And that's a trade-off, really. We're talking about empty houses versus full houses in a half-empty shopping center versus a productive a synagogue in a building, so we don't have an empty commercial building sitting empty. We are going to lose some tax revenue, but I think by making sure that the housing stock in the adjacent neighborhood stays full, which I believe it would stay full, because as the congregation grows, more people are going to look for homes close enough that it's within walking distance, and their children won't complain about having to walk, you know, too far. We got to take all of this into consideration. It's not just this building; it's the peripheral part of what's going on here that we have to take into consideration. So, this may not be the liking of some people, but I think the overall plan is, I think Southfield will come up again. So that's where I'm coming from.
Mr. Simon?
Mr. Stengel, there's a potential that, I realize that your congregation now lives in Oak Park, some, and some live in Southfield, and most live north of 10 Mile. But the potential is, because housing is short, that your congregants would look to the south of 10 Mile. It's very walkable, and that's within the perimeter of your congregation.
Yeah, I mean, you know, for some reason, I don't know why the south of 10 Mile didn't take off as much as the north of 10 Mile. Probably about a month and a half ago, about a month ago. I mean, after we announced that we're purchasing, and the community is extremely excited for it. There are four families that were living, I know personally, there are four families that are living in the Riverside Apartments in Oak Park that wanted to move to Oak Park. They wanted to move to Southfield, but again, there's not a lot of housing in north of 10 Mile. There were four houses going under foreclosure on the south side by Pierce, where there really isn't a large Jewish Orthodox community there. There's a few and not that much. And they decided, because the center is moving there, because the community is expanding, they were extremely excited. They put in bids and they purchased four houses. So I have no doubt that area is going to start to spread. I know that there are incentives even within the Jewish community, I think with the Jewish Federation, to purchase homes in that area.
and it's been extremely helpful for a lot of young families that have moved to the city. I can't tell you, you know, there's a lot of families moving in to the that I know of in our community. Could be doctors, could be lawyers, could be, you know, psychologists I know of, and meteorologists that moved in town, that are looking for places. And, you know, the incentives help, and to have a place within walking distance definitely helps. And I do believe that's going to take off. It may be a little, you know, it may take some time, but it's going to be there within five years, I believe.
Thank you.
You notice I've been keeping quiet, and everything that you said, I would have to say, but I have to, and I'll say yes with my vote. And what you said, Mr. Signal, is the amount of people that is going to move in here. I know of a number of 23 families are coming in. I know that. And you can figure out the taxes that would be paid by these 23 families, doubled and tripled up for the next year. So my answer is yes, and I won't go any further. Yes, and I think it's going to be successful. It'll stabilize the whole area, and it'll grow. I can't wait to see it.
I am, I'm in favor of it, of the use, but I will tell you that my biggest concern is the uniformity of that building. Next, that building that we're not talking about, the smaller building that's next door, there's an opportunity to move those buildings, although you don't own that other building, correct?
Which other buildings?
The smaller building outside the blue box. So would there be any desire, once you acquire the whole thing, to section it off so it is more private?
In terms of here?
Yeah.
Wait, well, I think one of the best benefits that we have is the fact that we are entering into a cross-access agreement with that for the parking. And, you know, I don't think we want to isolate it, but we're going to make it more friendly. We're going to put up a bike rack there. We're going to make it, you know, put up sidewalks there to make it more residential look like, so it's, you know, so it's becoming for the synagogue. I wouldn't think it would be in the best interest to sort of section it off, and because of the fact that we are having retail shops, I don't think it's too advantageous to the retail that we
There's a couple of things. I like the uniformity of the building. I think I agree that side of the building will look tired after the investment that you put in the other side. I like the fact that there's, you put the two sconces, whatever that is, and that can be an individual opening on that side. And then when you expand, you could just literally just expand internally, and it's complete on the outside. I was under the impression that you wanted the retail for your own use, like for bookstores and things like that, but that's not what you're going to do.
I mean, I think we're open in terms of Fashion International and Henry the Hatter have been landmarks in the city of Southfield. I think the last thing we want to do is to sort of remove them from the city.
I mean, what
they're
was
very
saying,
happy. You know, I told Henry the Hatter, you know, a lot of the Orthodox wear black hats.
Yeah.
So I think this would be a great business opportunity for him there also. So I think that would increase business.
So this is the other concern I have, and I'll ask our city planner. And I personally am aware of, because I'm young Israel area, I'm personally aware of the investment and have talked to members of your congregation. So I'm aware of the growth and excited about it. I'm so excited about it. And when I talk to the new families, to see their excitement about being in Southfield means a lot to me. the crossing of the street, walkways to the synagogue, I'm sure you, your architect has thought about that. And I really want to make sure that we give that some thought, especially if we're coming from the southern part or have to cross the street or whatever. So that's a concern of mine. And I will want to make sure that, that in the planning there's safe egress and crossing of the street for the children and for the families. The other thing is the snow removal and all those things. Are you going to be now separate from the mall? Those are type things I'm thinking
right,
about.
Right, we've talked to the owner of the New Orleans mall. We're going to go and probably go into a an agreement. You know, we have the same snow removal because we do share. I'm sorry. We have talked to the owner of the New Orleans mall. We are probably going to go into an agreement together with him with the snow removal because it is sort of a joint. We have, you know, we have a common parking there. So I think it's in both of our best interests. I think in terms of business-wise, you know, economy of scale is going to make more sense for both of us.
If I had my total desire, I would want you to occupy the whole building and remove the retail. I'm going to be very honest. That, to me, it separates the use. It is your property. It allows the community to identify that. I think it gives you a lot more because you're going to have parking from the residential, I mean from the commercial property during your time of worship, and there's a lot of cross-sectioning there. You know, it, we all want to live together, but I just, you know, most places of worship have a designated section around their place of worship where you can have, it's your congregation and it's your, but you're going to have parking on Saturday from all of these different uses. But that's something the community would have to work out. And to say reserved parking only, I don't know if that would work. But I really like, I prefer that. And even if you use the retail there, you see that there will be opportunity for new signage and to have the two separate doors. That to me is clean. To me, that is just a hodgepodge of it. And to me, it's not representative of what we would want for the synagogue. And because every synagogue who has invested in their place and work in their synagogue, it has been a major improvement and has been very welcoming. And to me, this kind of taps it off. It's connected. There's no way you cannot connect the two buildings. I don't care if it's inundated or not. So if you keep the retail, that would not be, you know, that would be the congregation's decision. But I would really appeal to you to please do the whole building so it would be a complete transition. I would think the investment up front, and then you can just go through it and make internal adjustments as you grow. But I'm excited about the community. In my state of the city, and every time I talk, you know, I talk about the excitement of the Jewish community growing in Southfield. And, you know, I've spoken to residents from New York who are just ecstatic about having a home and a yard, you know, and being able to be close to family and synagogue and all those things. So that's my only appeal. I really, really strongly ask that you would consider doing the entire building.
Okay, I've got a few questions. Okay, the facade and the appearance of the building to change. No one has yet told me what material are you applying to get that color. Is it face brick? Is it paint? What is it?
Are you talking about the finished material of the building?
The color, yeah. The color is not at all what the color of the current building
this,
is.
This building is fully face brick.
Okay.
The brick itself can be stained to almost any color you want at any time or anywhere.
No,
that's what you, if people would want to do that.
No, no, but our goal is not to stain the brick. Our goal is to match the facade that we have here, because this comes in multiple colors. That facade comes in multiple colors.
Yeah.
So our goal is to match that with the existing brick. It's all going to be uniform and match.
Match with
this brick.
Matching?
The This is going to match. This existing brick is here. Our goal is to take. I would ask you to picture, you know, picture this drawing with this color. Okay.
It's not
going to
be that
reddish
brown.
It's not going to be. It's not going to be the '70s brown. Okay. It's going to have an updated look. Correct. It's going to be a very good looking building.
It's going to be the color of the other of the existing building.
Correct. It's
right,
going to be.
And this one, these panels are supposed to be metallic panels, not wood.
Well, I want to ask about the panels, because they're going to cover up the windows. You said they were going to be plastic?
Metallic.
Metallic. But they're not plastic.
No.
They're metallic, and are they going to go over the front?
Pardon?
Are they going to go over the front windows?
They can't be installed
the
over the windows, yes.
So they're permanent, and they're weatherproof and all that.
Pardon?
I thought we were told they were plastic before. That's what I'm trying to understand.
It's the same material that's being used at the Darche Torah school on 12 Mile. That's what we're proposing to use. It's a very similar type of material.
So
it's a very, what's the name of that material?
It's a pressed metallic panel, and I can't remember the manufacturer.
But it's plastic or metal or some other combination?
The same metallic type panels that they used on the Chevrolet building on Telegraph Road. They also have metallic panels on the front of their building.
Okay, so it's permanent. It's weatherproof and all of that. Okay. And, I'm the only person that lives in that neighborhood, so I have maybe a different viewpoint than some of my colleagues. I can walk less than a half a mile from there. And my concern is, I don't think it should be entailed combined with the synagogue. I think that is, by all definitions, putting a religious organization, whether it's a church or synagogue, into what looks like a strip mall. That piece of property is part of New Orleans Mall, correct? I mean, it is part of New Orleans Mall. I know there are vacancies in New Orleans Mall because we're in a bad recession right now. That mall is not a strip mall. New Orleans Mall is a shopping center. And my concern is that taking this out of the retail, out of the retail class, further weakens the New Orleans Mall. That's been a staple of that neighborhood. You mentioned the two retailers, the Hatters and the other store, but there have been a lot of shops in there over the years, Ephro's Drugstore, Shopping Center Market before Kosher One took in, that provided so much for people that live in the Highland Towers, people that live in the Senior Center in Oak Park, and the Jewish community Senior Center. It's been it's a very important, not just your average strip center. I think when the economy comes back, I think it's going to liven up and come back. And so I had the concern that taking this out of the retail, just as a matter of principle, I don't support putting a religious institution into a commercial retail spot. I applaud you for wanting to come to the area and live here. And I don't have any problem with living in the neighborhood or being in that area. I'm concerned about the larger picture of the New Orleans Mall. That does concern me that as there's something called critical mass, that if you want your shops and stores to be supported, you need stores around them to bring people there so that they all survive. And as I see each one going out of business or going to another use, particularly going to another use, I feel long range it's going to be harmful as a commercial center to the New Orleans Mall. So for that reason, I can't support this. But I also, if I were to be in favor of the project, I would not want to see the retail in there. I think that it's a storefront church by everybody's definition. And to me, it could present problems for us. It is setting a precedent. And I think it definitely could present problems to us as a city, even though it's a consent resident. There's no guarantee that it wouldn't set a precedent and present some problems for us. So I'm sorry to say that I cannot support this particular use in this particular spot.
I would point out that as far as shopping goes in the area, Melfar Ford went out, and we have a drugstore there is probably what impacted EFROS. We have a row of restaurants and stores, a couple of which are vacant, right across Greenfield and Oak Park. This is competition for that mall, I mean, for new large and small. I think it's presented a challenge for the owner to fill the vacant spaces. I mean, there's more retail there now than there was before.
The drugstore across the street did not affect EFROS. EFROS retired, and that's why EFROS went out of business.
But it's you know, a lot of the independent drugstores went by and by because of the chain, the big chain.
Well, I've lived there for 38 years, and I think I know more about the neighborhood than you do. We've had a larger drugstore up on the other, just a minute, we had a larger drugstore right up the street where we used to have a Farmer Jack. And we had a drugstore right now at the beauty store. So we haven't lost, we haven't gained anything extra. We still have one drugstore in the area.
I'll strike my comment about it. The point is, there are more stores than there were.
Well, you're not a member of the council, and I've been criticized for letting you speak, so I really would prefer that you not end our conversation. Mr. Moss.
Excuse me. Can I have a question, and
all right,
can I have a consensus around the table whether I can ask a question, please?
No, I'll let you ask a question. No.
Okay.
I will let you ask a question, but you do this to us a lot, and I get a lot of criticism for it because you're not a member of council. I'm not trying to be rude to you, but I'm getting criticism from it.
Well, but maybe we should all talk about this at a later date. My question to the attorney, because this is a consent judgment, and there are two separate visual plans, mm-hmm. will this come back before the council site plan committee for review?
Why would that interest you? Because you're not part of the site plan committee. It's not going to come back to the site plan committee. Why does that matter? I'm curious.
I guess because as a resident of this city, I also am concerned about the look of this particular corner.
But you're here as a clerk, and you're not a member of council. You're not speaking as a resident of the city, Nancy. I can't let you continue this. I really can't. Mr. Moss, did you have your hand up?
Yeah, I did. I have other concerns, but I just want to go forward with first because we've been talking a little bit in circles on this, which is fine. It's what it's here. We're here to discuss it. But the point is, they've already bought the property. So I mean, whatever
you have you bought the property?
We're under contract. We're under contract.
You have an agreement, but you haven't purchased.
Yeah, the purchase agreement is on the property.
You
correct.
Have a purchase agreement. Okay, go
ahead. So they are entering this purchase agreement with the idea that the retail is going to help them keep the property and have a 5-year vision to go to that. So I think, it seems like there's a majority of council right now that is okay with either incarnation of this keeping the retail. So I think I would like to get the conversation focused on which one. And I know that maybe that's jumping the gun a bit, but it seems like we have enough of a consensus around that I'm at peace with the retail staying. I'm at peace with moving forward on something sooner rather than later because it seems like they've been delayed for a bit, and we want to be a community that's open to business. And I've just seen so much process that you can go back and forth to 1,000 different places, and I think we're at a place where we can approve of one or the other. I understand your concerns. My only thing is I feel like we're pushing them to go there when they're not ready to go there yet. And I think the ultimate vision is that. But again, I'm at peace with it. if they accept that, and Harry Henry the Hatter wants to have their business frontage look like that, I'm not going to be a roadblock to it. My personal preference and logic goes with that one. But I support either one of them. I think we just need to figure out a way to move forward with something. So my question is, how do we do that? Can we move forward with this with a vote, or what is the process? Does it go to the site plan?
Can I mention something to you before you? One of the concerns of the site plan committee and some concerns that we've had just among some of the staff is that this, even though it's a consent agreement, the potential is that it could be setting a precedent for other storefront churches once we do this. That's been a big concern. We have churches right now meeting in homes, meeting in office buildings, and if one of the concerns, Jeremy, was that this could set a precedent, and I don't know that it could because of consensus.
Can I ask the attorney that does it set a precedent?
Yes, but I just, you understand what I'm getting at.
I do.
That's a big concern.
And that's a fair concern, but I'm at peace with it. I speak as a council member. Does that set a precedent to do that?
Well, this is a consent judgment, so there is more flexibility with this. This is not a pure zoning matter. So obviously, if there are other issues going on in terms of vacant retail or supporting other retail, there's just other things that are coming into consideration here that I think by building it as part of a new consent judgment or a modification to the consent judgment, the precedential value can be negated. But I do agree that whatever the agreement is should be incorporated into the modification, so you know exactly what you're getting, and whatever other restrictions you want in terms of parking or pedestrian safety or whatever, that all of those are built in and made an actual exhibit to this modification. So it's nailed down exactly what it is that council wants.
Okay, so then I guess the heart of what I'm saying is actually is what our city clerk's concern is. What is the next step? Is this now going to have to go back again to the site plan with a vote that we take tonight? I mean, I would like to see us vote on something that moves it forward rather than just keep talking about it.
I just would say I don't think it should go back to site plan because that's why it's in front of full council.
I agree.
So
I do agree with that. I do agree with that.
We have seen all of the facades. There's nothing new for us to see in terms of the elevation, correct? We've seen the, I should be asking Mr. Mandel, that we've seen the final elevation that are proposed. So there's nothing to come back to site plan committee for, I don't believe. Jeff?
Oh, which
okay.
one of the two?
Yeah, which one?
Which one of the two is going to be the elevation?
I'm of the belief it's that one.
I think we should vote.
Yeah, right. It came to us already. It was a 2-1 figure for Hattie and her and myself. They were 2. No, I was against. Oh,
I didn't
know.
Well,
that's right.
I didn't know.
She was
a
bystander of the meeting.
But just for clarification, the vote would be which elevation. You're not voting because there will be a public hearing scheduled for this,
right.
So that there would be other, citizens have
it's
rights.
Really a consensus.
I was commenting on, we were talking again about the retail and everything like that, and it seemed that the majority of us were okay with the retail remaining intact. So I wanted to get beyond the retail into how is it going to look with the retail in it.
Can we get a consensus on which elevation? Give these folks some direction.
Oh, I see. Okay, we'll go around the table. Let's start with one of
those.
I know. I'm just saying. Is that what you want to do? You want to pick one of them?
Yes, exactly right.
Let's pick the one on my left that shows everything the same, no difference.
What you do is you say, which one do you prefer? And then you count the votes when you
all
get
right,
all
right, we'll do it that way. Which one do you prefer? We'll start with Ms. Moss.
I prefer the one on the right.
With the retail.
With the retail. All of them have the retail.
We'll call that the retail.
Okay.
Whatever they both have, and we'll call that the retail version. Okay, so that's one. Mr. Frazier.
Retail.
They both have retail.
Right,
well,
we're calling that one
retail.
I vote for the right one on the right.
Wait, does this make sense, or should we?
Yeah,
okay,
keep going.
Okay, good.
So
all right.
Let's come out to the right result.
Got it.
Picasso.
I'll go to the right.
The retail one?
Well, the bonus retail.
The one on the right is the one on the right.
The one on the right.
Well, it's really difficult, and that is that.
That's the right
that
one.
This
is the left one.
Things that you're viewing are not accurate. From the color,
we understand that.
The
yeah.
color is the same, and so it doesn't reflect what they really look like. Neither one of them.
True.
You know,
I'm going
so
with Brooklyn.
Kind of my imagination.
Moving along.
Really, we should decide. I mean, some of us aren't going to have either one, so it's going to be. probably, maybe we should decide, first of all, who wants it and who doesn't, and then pick which one you want.
That's fair, too.
Let's start over. Okay. I'm going to go on the table. If you want one of these to go ahead, Mr. Fratasi?
Yes.
Mr. Frazier?
Yes.
Mr. Moss?
Yes.
Mr. Seiber? Ms. Jordan?
No.
Mr. Lance?
Yes.
And I say no. Now we'll go with which elevation you want.
I am concerned that we're going to have a public hearing. We are directing them which ones to do. Shouldn't they get direction from us, go back and do whatever they're going to do, and come back and present what they're going to present?
Yeah, that's what we're right now telling them, finding out which one we like, which one the council likes. We'll go to another step after that. All right, so let's start over again. We've got Mr. Moss, Mr. Cassie, Mr. Frazier like the right one, is that
yes,
correct?
Yes.
And Mr. Seiber?
Right retail.
You like the right, and Mr. Lance?
Well, I still get a vote.
Well, just, all right, what do you like?
Left.
You like the left.
I don't want it, but I want the left.
All right. And you want the right one. Okay, so that's five right, one left, and one doesn't want either.
What is yours?
I'm not in favor of having a religious institution, whether it's a church, a synagogue, whatever, in a commercial venue. So
can I make just a quick clarification as well? So since that now is presumably the site plan that's going to be used as the basis of the elevation, are you building in anything that Mr. Crone had indicated about maybe having some updates in it? Do you want to see another elevation back with maybe some of the things that Mr. Crone was talking about?
Could I just offer a suggestion through the chair? In order to move this forward, there's at least a consensus about moving it forward. We'd like to be able to schedule this for July 30th public hearing, and we would like to be able to meet the timing requirements to get the public hearing. At the same time, we could come back to a study session in July prior to that public hearing, but it would be after the date we would have to set it, and we will work with the applicant on trying to take all the comments and come up
with
a rendering
that's
accurate
rendering,
and maybe incorporate some upgrades without changing the whole facade. And we would bring it back to your July COW meeting prior
make
to the
it
public.
Look more realistic.
That's correct.
With whatever.
But this way, at least, we're not this allows us to set the public hearing for the July 30th meeting and still come back to council prior.
I'll take a vote. I would prefer the one with the retail. So I guess that's the one. If I were going to
thank you very much. If I can ask one more thing, I'm not into this whole procedure. I don't know what it was. I hear a lot of this Rule 10 being thrown around tonight. Is there any way that we can get a Rule 10 on the approval process?
No.
No.
Okay.
Got a lot to learn. Not everything needs that.
Okay, great. Thank you very much.
Our goal, but I would hate to make
this conditional upon that, because who knows what's going to happen in 5 years. There's a lot of things that go on. That's our goal. We even want that to happen.
Okay.
But I don't want that to be a condition that, okay, it has to be a timeline that has to be done in 5 years. Maybe we'll do it in 2 years. If we can get a big, you know, big donation.
Oh, yeah.
In. But, I mean, what, I mean, you know, considering the retail space, you want to keep them there, but
the
I want you to, you know, to be cognizant of that from our standpoint. You know, we want to have flexibility
and
there.
That.
Correct.
Okay. The only thing I would like to see is what, since the vote was to keep it with the retail, what would the phase-in look like? So when you're presenting it, and you're saying whatever that time frame is, this will be the expectation of what the phase-in will look like.
Our goal could be, okay, let's put it back or something like that.
Yeah.
As simple as that.
Just, that's the only thing I'm saying, so there's an expectation. Thank you.
Great question, and I would tell you to contact your local rabbi.
Young, and aren't being done properly to shut a job down. Believe it or not, for some reason, they were all reluctant to take that responsibility. We indicated to them that our goal in any job when it's done is what we call a ribbon cutting. That's the goal, fit and finish, and work we can be proud of. And in order to do that, they had to agree to some contract provisions, which frankly enhances the responsibility because they have to own up to. All the companies have agreed to that. So in the short term, we have improvement noted. However, we need an extension to go through December. We need to bid the engineering out, and we will be formulating a bid process between now and December. In order to get federal funding, every 5 years you have to bid out your engineering. This is the fifth year, and we are going to continue to qualify for funds from every source. So there'll be a bid process. In the meantime, consistent with the requirements we've set up and the jobs that are underway now, and really no new work of any great consequence, we would like to suggest an extension through December 31st. We'll come back on June 18th with that sort of council action.
Did you say you don't want a rule 10?
No rule 10. We'll be coming back June 18th. This is just simply so the council will understand what we're doing and why we're doing it. And we will, the item will be basically the same format that you're seeing. Yes, George, I'm
here. Yes. For the record, and I know we briefly spoke by Mr. Schubert. Originally, when we had this discussion, it was probably about 5 years ago, and we talked about, you know, the majority of the engineering contract going to HRC, we added some additional engineering firms. What you have presented before us, are there any of these projects that could be shifted to Tucker Young, or all of these are existing projects and there's nothing new that they can get? Because again, it just seems like HRC is getting the lion's share of our engineering services, and I do want to make sure that, you know, that big discussion we had before, that the work is being, you know, equally distributed based upon who can do what. So can you help me out there?
Can we do Tucker Young on 12 Mile Road on the water?
Yeah.
We use Tucker Young for some consulting after the OHM project was done. They helped us with some of the pressures up there. We do have them they're doing some work for us right now. They are doing at Northland we have to put in a new vault for our meters down there, and we have to run some new services down there because the water main is basically falling apart. So they're in the process of doing that right now. And there will be probably three more water projects coming up this next fiscal year that they will get the work on that. They're basically very strong in the water field. They do some road construction, but their specialty is water pressure, large tunnels for sewers. That's what they specialize in.
Might add that our capital improvement program, most of the projects that are the most expensive projects in the upcoming are water projects.
I am looking forward to this going out for a full
day. We'll have the detail of who got what.
Okay.
And we'll be weaving in the CIP with that. But the predominant jobs are water jobs.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Tonight we did a Rule 10 to ask for the grant to do the parking lot over in Inglenook. Assuming that the grant is going to be approved, how do we go about assigning that to one of these three or not?
That would be a stormwater project. ECT is currently under contract for the stormwater. We'd probably look
to them first. They've worked with staff to write the stormwater grant. Most of our grants have come through as part of our stormwater plan.
CT, environmental consultant.
But what about the pervious parking lot?
That would be EECT. They did the design at Beechwood that was completed in the last 18 months. That was their design work, and that is part of stormwater management.
However, I do think the whole line of questioning would need clarification. Who gets what?
Yes.
Needs clarification.
Right.
There's no question about it, because I couldn't make a whole lot of sense out of certain road jobs that got signed every which way. I think we're asking ourselves many more questions behind that line.
Well, and the process that'll happen between now and December will be the federal requirements are that we go through a request for qualifications. As we go through that request for qualifications, we don't ask for what they're charging us until the end. And that's one of the things. I mean, do we have enough work to be dividing our work up amongst four different engineering firms? And even some of the engineering companies are saying, this isn't the old days, your volume of work is half of what it used to be. And I can tell you, both OHM and HRC have made similar remarks to both Mike and myself. ECT is very different, because right now our stormwater is being driven by within our engineering division, and our parks and rec are working very closely on that, and a lot of those stormwater projects we've done have been related to our parks and water quality and the impact of the roof.
Most of your work on road jobs are just state jobs.
This year, OHM is doing Civic Center Drive.
Correct.
HRC is doing Beach Street Bridge.
They're doing Beach Road Bridge.
And then they're working with us on Evergreen. And as Mike said, when the stimulus projects came out, council authorized us to work on engineering on five projects. Those have now been queuing up annually in the phaser system, and they're scoring. So we're going to see funding for those projects move forward.
More about Evergreen.
Evergreen Road, too?
Evergreen Road is in that right now. HRC is working with us on the right-of-way acquisition issues. They're too minor, and that is scheduled for 2014. Once we get through the acquisition, there is a possibility of moving that up to 2013.
No, this is the way it will come to you on the 18th. That's why it is. It should have marked draft up here. And that's why we have it dated the 18th. Next item is the budget adjustment. Council's well aware. We have appeals. We have funds. They are funded. We need to move the funding into the budgets. If we don't, we have technical deficits in each of the funds. We don't want any technical deficits. That brings a negative image to the city. It's totally unnecessary. We've got some homework to do, because there are new audit regulations, new nomenclature, and I've already contacted Alicia Davis of Plant Moran, and she's aware of this. We're just simply letting you know that on the 25th, the reason we're deferring it to the 25th is to absolutely preclude the possibility that any department spends this money in any way except for appeals, because by the time it gets moved in on the 25th, business is closed, basically, for the fiscal year. So this, again, is another item that we'll be bringing forth at a later date. This one on the 25th, this hearing on the 18th. I might add, backing up to engineering, the Franklin Road, one of our projects that we didn't get the quality we wanted. Started a batch, the engineering company shut it down. That's what we want them to do. That's what we've told them over and over we want them to do, is make sure it's right and take charge of the project. And I don't know quite how it ever got to be any other way. It's counterintuitive to do it any other way. But happened, and we analyzed why we weren't getting the appropriate quality, and we've taken steps. And anyone that bids engineering from henceforth will have a standard, and the standard's very clear. But they're responsible for the quality of the job. When we're done, yeah, we want a ribbon cutting. That's the level of quality we want. Fit and finish, no barrels sitting around, nothing, everything looking sharp and ready for ribbon cutting. That's our goal. And last but not least, request a scheduled council meeting.
I'd move a rule 10 for item number 10.
Support. Yes, we do.
Yeah.
Motion on Mr. Stivers, supported by Don Duffy. Okay.
Then I would move to schedule a regular council meeting.
Yeah,
for oh, I'm sorry. I'm ready.
He's rolling.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Now I'll make my motion to schedule a regular council meeting for June 25th.
Supported,
Don?
Okay.
All
in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion has carried.
Thank you very much. This puts up the schedule.
Excuse me, is it the regular time? 7?
Yes.
7 o'clock.
Yeah, a lot of public hearing issues get split that way, and so it works a lot better.
Okay. Now we have a couple of communications questions. First, there's some news that Mr. Gary Davis is here. Mr. Gary Davis?
Ma'am, I spoke to Mr. Davis Friday evening, and the situation he expressed concern about, the dumpster has been removed. Yes, and he indicated he may or may not be here at that point.
Okay, so he's not here. The second person listed is Stephanie Lewis.
Stephanie English, 287. Stephanie English, 28735 San Carlos, Southfield, 48076. And I'm here for myself and for the residents of the Green Trees Homeowners Association. May 28th at approximately 11:20 p.m., there was a funnel cloud that tore through my subdivision, and it caused massive damage within Green Trees. I have to thank today all of the people with the city of Southfield who assisted us. It is just as you hear on TV, it is a freight train that approaches. It scared me in a way that I had never experienced fear before. Houses, the transformers blew, fires on the power pole, trees snapped, trees fell on the homes, two houses to one side, two houses to the other. Trees snapped within the whole subdivision. It looked like a bomb had gone off in our sub. But the fear that ensued with everyone was really quickly allayed through the night and through the next day. And I look away from my paper because I really want the city and leaders to know how everybody came together. I need to thank the responding police persons that answered the lines, including the dispatch person who took about 100 calls. The fire department, they responded right away. We were in our pajamas in the middle of the night. It was dark. Mm-hmm. And as they started cutting the trees that fell across the streets at about 3:45 in the morning, I have to thank Mr. Frank Coots, who contacted me after I called him hysterically. Through all of that, with candles in my house, I had my city cards in one place in a paper clip. All I could see with a flashlight were these numbers, Mike Kabowski's number, Frank Coots' number. They all called me to help me guide through the processes because as afraid as I was, the neighbors were trying to come to me to ask what they should do. And I was afraid myself, but these people I know really came together to help us. Terry Crow took calls from me because we had bootleg contractors, roofing contractors, and tree people who were not licensed to do work. And at our most vulnerable points, these people were coming in to try to solicit business from us without maybe following the proper procedures. I need to thank Audrey, the receptionist, and also Peggy in the clerk department, because Audrey helped me when I came in sweaty, trying to find the tree list to distribute to the people who had all the trees that fell on the home, and the damage was massive. It was homes where the family rooms were taken out, roofs where the trees went through the family rooms. We had four houses like that. It was, like I said, like a bomb went off. Also, too, especially to the public works areas, Leo, the tree manager, came through our subdivision. He was actually there with us to help us and tell us that they would help pass the regular pickup day for the trash, pass the pickup of the tree companies that were in to take the trees away. We had the cooperation of our city leaders and our city department people that just helped us in a time of need. I feel that rooting for a home team, and also now I would add to my list, devastation or these kind of massive emergencies bring neighbors together in a way that it normally does not connect us. And I didn't even know some people had children. When there's no power, children come outside. So, but the thing is, I must tell you that it is with great gratitude that I come here. Normally I come for another issue, and I need to speak very positively and give the highest praise to everyone. The fire department, Chief Raleigh, I want to tell you that I feel that the fire department was instrumental in getting DTE to move. The amount of transformer and wires coming down was so pervasive, and I mean we're talking arcing wires, and the way the fire, you know, blew out from all of the poles, it was the scariest thing. But they came, and I'm betting every penny that I have that it was your guys that really moved DTE, because we just don't think there could have been any influence. Also, too, Mr. Charette was driving around in the car driven by Donald Fricassi, although they didn't stop to address the citizens. I could tell. I made eye contact with Mr. Charette. No, I saw you, Mr. Charette. He connected with me in the car. And I did. I left him some scathing messages on his answering machine. But I know he was putting everything into play. And we are extremely, extremely grateful. And I thank everybody that came together and helped Green Trees. I really appreciate it, and I'm grateful. Pamela Gerald, P.O. Box 1.
Is when are we going to get a permanent police and fire chief?
It's purported.
Excuse me, guys.
This is really disruptive.
You get another 10 minutes.
I know, because you're in charge. It is purported that our former police chief, Dr. Joseph E. Thomas, also known as the Jet, will be returning as the public safety director. And I just wanted to know, is this true? And it's also purported that if the Jet does not come back, that the process to look for a permanent police chief is going to start all over again. Why is this council and administration dragging their feet about this very important task? And that is selecting a police chief. It's imperative to do that now. What's the holdup? We have an in-house chief that is exceptionally qualified with education, experience, and demeanor. And that's what we want, leadership for the police department. And what's the status on the contract? Are we going to give our police officers who risk their lives for the residents and the city officials who provide me with excellent and exceptional detail, these meetings, are we going to give them a contract? And are we going to settle the arbitration? And my last point, and Mr. Moss, you said I don't say anything good, I'd like to give credit where credit is due. On June the 7th of this year, I attended a joint meeting of Council Neighborhood Services Committee and Legislative and Urban Affairs Committee, and boy, was I impressed. I was impressed because I saw Councilman Kenson Zeiger in a way that I had never seen him before. He's highly educated, and he presided over the meeting. The meeting was very, very productive. In that meeting, they discussed much-needed changes that have been requested by the residents and members of our coalition, Southfield Citizens Oversight Coalition. More importantly, the meeting was professional. Imagine how productive the council meetings would be if Councilman Kenson Seifer was president, presiding over the council meeting. And I just wanted to give you a quote from our former president, Harry S. Truman. He said, "It is amazing what you can accomplish if you do not care who gets the credit." So, with that, I want to say I appreciate it. And I'm going to start talking under 5 minutes. So we won't have to have the disruptions that you alluded to. And please turn off your cell phones during the council meetings. You got to make that announcement.
You call the room from our daughter, the men's room or ladies' room, unless they ask permission.
Only if you shut your cell phone off.
Is Mr. William Dawson here?
Beach.
And now that I'm retired and I'm spending a lot of time outdoors, especially now in the warm weather, even in the winter, I do a lot of walking. And in the area where I live, there's no sidewalk. And there's a park on Beach, I'm sure you all know this, and there's also a park on 10 Mile. And it would be nice to walk to those parks rather than to get into the car. So I had a chance to take a look at a document called the Non-Motorized Pathway and Public Transit Plan. And in that plan, there's a lot of detailed information, because before coming here, I had done some research on a federal level, but then I was informed that here's something that the city of Southfield has already completed, but nothing has been implemented. So all I'm asking, it's a major plan, and if that could be implemented, that would be great for the entire city. But my concern, which is a little bit selfish, is primarily just from Telegraph west to Southfield, Inkster, on 10 miles. And a sidewalk also from Beach and 10 miles down to 9 miles. I don't know what that would take. Is it necessary for me to go out and get a petition, to get more residents to sign it, to make things happen? Or just by coming here, would that stir enough to make something happen? That's my question. Can I get an answer for that?
The best thing to do is to do some homework on this, to advise, unless we have someone that...
I'll take a stab at it. The reason why we completed the non-motorized pass system is to set up a vehicle that, as future road construction projects are in place, the funding for the sidewalks will be put in. What you just threw out about each mile of sidewalk is about $100,000, and I just roughly counted four miles, about $600,000 worth of work on both sides of 10 mile, 2 miles, that's 4 miles, and the beach is another, so you get about 6 miles of sidewalk at about $600,000. There could be issues with right-of-ways and legal. 10 Mile is a county road, so the next time the road is built, now that this document's been in place, the county will have to put the sidewalks in. What will be interesting is the cemetery piece. I would need to look at the right-of-way there. The other alternative would be to do it all by special assessment, and that's a pretty expensive project. But by having this document in place, as grant opportunities come along, we can apply for those funding opportunities. The reality is, if you did some researching at the federal level, you probably saw the country's been over 2 years with no national road policy. And part of that is there's two big debates. One, this weekend there's a big article about fly ash and the percentage of fly ash, and there's some environmental concerns over that and concrete mix. The other is this concept of complete streets. There are some in this country who think we should just be focused on streets first. Sidewalks and other pedestrian amenities are secondary. I'm not in agreement with that, but that's critical. Why is that important? When we do a project, we're usually only paying 10% of the cost. So on a $600,000 project, the local match would probably be more the range of, on the county road, I'll use that, out of $400,000 would be $40,000. We could probably come up with $40,000. I really don't think we can come up with $400,000 to do 10 mile. And these are the challenges we face. The document is a planning document. It locks, it actually requires Oakland County, complete streets, now requires the county when they redo that road, they have to put that sidewalk in. Before the complete streets legislation was put in place, they didn't have to. And now that we've got a planning document that says we want it, they have to do it. I know it's not the answer you want to hear, but it's the reality of road funding that we face as a community.
Okay, well, let me ask this. If there's four voices on one voice, if there's, say, 50,000 voices, would that make a difference?
voices always make a difference, but again, this is about money. And are the voices willing to raise the money?
Well, the money is there. It's just a matter of how you're going to allocate the money. Because other things, I've been sitting here today, there's a lot of things that have been planned. So the sidewalk is an issue that I'm concerned about. The other things that were discussed today, I don't care. But the point I'm making also is that, okay, I understand the non-motorized plan. That's looking, you know, way into the future. I mean, there's a lot of things, a lot of interesting stuff in that document, which if that could be implemented, that would be wonderful. But I know that's going to cost a lot of money. I'm just looking at just from 10 Mile and Inkster to 10 Mile and Telegram, even if you don't do beach.
So just doing one side is still $200,000. And I agree, but this is about funding. But I'll share with you, this morning we got an email from the Michigan Department of Transportation about bridges, critical bridges, and bridges that need to be repaired by December 31 of 2012. About a $2.5 million problem landed in our mailboxes at 9 o'clock this morning. So there's a lot of competing priorities. And what some folks are saying, it's the hierarchy of a pedestrian system, moving a volume. And some folks are saying moving the cars first are before the pedestrians. I'm in agreement with you, but there are a lot of competing constraints. How we come up for, you heard earlier, we're still struggling where we're going to come up with the $1.1 million to rebuild Evergreen Road. There are lots of pressure points for these funds, and that's why we're hoping to secure additional funds. It would be great if we had national legislation in place, so if those voices work to move that forward. But I will tell you, this area's congressman is in favor of the legislation, as well as both of this state senators. So it's moving other people who aren't in favor of that legislation, getting them to move might be the best thing to help us fund these projects.
I've just got a quick, and I live in the area and I walk along Samoset, but you cannot walk along 10 miles. Is there any way, and I know we have to do some research, that we could possibly do a special assessment in that area or get petitions to see those that may want to buy into special assessment? I know that's the west side of the town, and a lot of the lots are large, and people moved over there for the acreage, but that has changed now, and people do want to walk over there.
Let me say this to you. You know, City of Southfield is like two different cities, and the west side of the city is rural in character, and the topography with the Rouge is difficult. Clusters rights away that are difficult to acquire. The thing that has to happen to get that sidewalk in would have to have petitions, and if 60% of the residents counter petition the petition, by charter we have to abandon the project. So each time that we have tried in some areas to put in sidewalks, we've had counter petitions between the 60%, they must be abandoned.
So
you get petitions, but I mean that's what our charter says.
What was the counter? I mean, what was there doing in the opposition?
They don't want sidewalks.
They don't want to pay.
But you look at 10 Mile Road, you get down into the area between Beach and Inkster, you've got terrain there. I call it the beautiful street beautiful because of all the beautiful trees, but you have the ravines going through there. So there's not even a way in which you could even do that unless you do like they do in some areas. You just widen the road and put a white strip there, and that would designate a walking area.
Bike lane.
A bike path. But that would be the only way. You couldn't actually build a sidewalk like that is done in most subdivisions on the east side of the city. But I've been here almost all my life, and that's been a subject.
Because my background is in engineering.
Yes.
not civil, I'm an electrical engineer. But I could see that there's ways of doing that on 10 miles. I mean, there's partial ways already where there's a white line that's kind of given, you know, a pedestrian.
By the new bridge, down the 9 mile road, they have put lines across that bridge. My daughter lives right there at Ravine at 9 mile road, and I know she's a walker. Kids are too. They're both all joggers.
But there's a sidewalk on.
They go into ravines and jog.
There's a sidewalk on.
Just on the bridge.
No, there's a sidewalk that goes from beach all the way to Inglenook.
And 9 miles of city road under our jurisdiction.
Yeah, but there's no sidewalk there.
Yeah, one side there.
Where?
Well,
it's
on the street.
Yeah, yeah. But I mean, what I'm trying to say is it's not a sidewalk where you have a curb and an easement and then a.
Well, that's true.
I mean, we tried to get Bell Road, for example, to have sidewalks, and it's because of the Orthodox Jewish community that walks, or the Jewish community that walks to Sherazetic. And one person objected to the project, and we had all the money up front for that, and we could not do it.
Because of one person?
Mm-hmm. Wouldn't give us right away. I mean, I understand where you're going. You know, I have a sidewalk. I enjoy my sidewalk, you know. But, you know, some people wanted rural and kept rural, and you know, that's the way it is. I mean, you know, I mean, years ago they had Taxpayers League. It was Mr. Urex and Mr. Riley, and we were going to put storm sewers down the ravines so that the water would flow with the topography. And they took us to court and stopped us from putting a sewer in the ravines. And now we have 16 pump stations on the east side of the west side of the city, so that we have to pump water up and make it flow. And pay for all these motors that go bad and all that expense. So, you know, the west side of the city have different ideas of what they would like to have.
So if I was able to obtain these petitions?
You can get a petition, and imagine the clerk's office would help you. I don't know. I'd help you.
I know, but say if I was able to do that, then... Well,
in your credit card committee, you bring them all the councils, file them with the
but
clerk.
But then I'll be faced with the same thing about we don't have the money, we have this, we have that.
Madam Chair, we would like to discuss and sit down with you and give you all the options that you have so that you can be empowering the clerk and the council president can direct you to the department head, because you do have a lot of valid issues, but there's a lot of information we need to provide you. So I would ask.
I don't think you understand. Maybe you don't, but
You live in.
Okay.
Okay.
Was that yeah. Talk about it?
We had a dinner meeting a couple weeks ago. I didn't see you there. Gail Mazey. I live on West Kenmore.
Do you recognize you before?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, let me get some. I have something ahead of me.
Okay, fine. I have to. She called me up.
No, I was doing it. He needed to talk to you.
No. It's just not going to happen. I've got 400 feet on Kenmore. You want me to pay for this?
No. I just wanted to understand what's going on. All right, the next
person is Gerard Holland and Peter. Who's that?
Okay, that's Gerard Holland and Peter.
You still here?
No.
Oh,
all right.
Well,
we have some
Thank you.
policy so that if people want a tax abatement and they have litigation pending, in other words, they're appealing their taxes and they still want tax abatement, our policy says we're not going to do that. If they're in litigation, appealing their taxes, we don't give a tax abatement. We want to change that or we want to remain with that?
I don't want to change it.
I just want to confirm that.
You're looking at me, I'm telling you, I don't want to change it. Keep it the way it is. Mr. Frazier? 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 Keep it the way it is. Mr. Fr
There is a sign that says no left turn right at 10 miles, just shy of Evergreen and the Green Island. And everybody totally ignores that no left turn sign at 10 miles.
Kirby.
Yep. I'd like to know if you can either take some police officers there.
That is the
Sylvia Jordan no left turn sign.
Every time I drive by it, I think of you. We got the Sylvia Jordan left turn sign at 10 mile of Evergreen.
On my street, and I hate to talk about the Pawnshops, there are a lot of trees and limbs that many of the residents have put in their yard and they haven't been picked up, and I think it's because it's too long, you know, cutting all that other stuff.
You don't have to bundle
them
up.
They're just long branches.
Can't get it or something. Long damage? Yes.
Yeah. They are, Waste Management is falling a little bit behind. They're kind of not doing too well right now this week. I have a meeting with them on Wednesday morning. First time I could get with them. Like Mr. Snyder said, they do have packers out there throwing stuff in the back of the packers, but that's, we need chippers out there because they have your brush. So we are also going to look at sending a couple crews out of our own to get caught up.
We're only about
65%. So we need to get your area, that section there is real bad, and so is
Thank you. In light of that, there are some on 9 mile. I don't think anybody's gonna pick that up because it's lumber. It's like somebody did a project over the weekend and
okay.
It's out front. And I know we don't typically pick up lumber, but it's right across from one of the garden centers.
Okay. All right.
But I have another question. A couple of weeks ago, we got letter from a taxi company that wants to do business in the city of Southfield. Was that just information that we just read it and not do anything about it, or are we going to act on it? Are we going to?
I think it was Drew.
The little checker cab company.
Yeah. He said he grew from 7 cabs to 35 cabs or whatever, and he wants to do business in Southfield. And
maybe the clerk knows.
This particular situation, this gentleman came to our counter and he had requested 35 bond plates. He said he presently operates in the city of Detroit and he wants to expand to Southfield. We told him at the present time we weren't issuing bond plates, and that when council does decide to issue additional bond plates, there is a procedure that has always been in place in the city of Southfield, and that is, you know, we would advertise, bring people in to interview. We reviewed the taxi cab situation several years ago, and some of the not-so-pleasant drivers are no longer driving in the city. It seems like, you know, the police department can confirm that we finally have a good group of people. So I think he just wasn't happy with the answer, so he went a step further, and he wants a bond plate. We We told them that we are not issuing bond plates, and we gave them a copy of the...
For what reason?
I'm sorry?
For what reason are we not issuing bond plates?
Because there has been no... I mean, we're issuing bond plates to the companies that presently have it. We have not been issuing any new bond plates. We haven't for years. Number one, there hasn't been a need, it seems like. At one point, we were researching Fred Thorne, whether we were going to open up the process and work with the SEMTA
if I may, Madam President,
yes.
Within the non-motorized transportation plan, we talked about reviewing our taxi cab ordinances, but getting greater reciprocality between communities that they're recognized, and most cities individually control that, so you've got an impairment to mobility in the marketplace. If you could set something up regionally that if I'm a cab operator, I can operate from Southfield to Ferndale, pick up a fare in Ferndale, come back, or even to the airport. We've set up all these barriers. The other piece of that would be to take a cue from what the Detroit Visitors Convention Bureau did, and you teach basic hospitality training to your cab folk, and you get someone. And I could tell you, SEMCOG would probably love to work with us on it. Cabs, and think about this in the hierarchy of transportation planning, are part of a public transportation planning process. And there are a lot of the green cabs have popped up, and you see all these different companies. And I think that competition could ultimately be very healthy for Southfield, at the same time ensuring that you're protecting public safety, that you have reputable folks who own and operate these cabs. It is one of the line items within the plan, and we're not tackling it yet, are we? Or, I mean, we are working on some other pieces of the transportation plan, but we can move it up as a priority. And I know for a fact SEMCOG would love to see greater regional cooperation on that.
Well, having recent experience of not being able to drive, getting around Southfield is more of a challenge than not. And if we had more options on how to get around Southfield, it might be helpful for a lot of people that, that are staying at home and or find it very difficult to get to the grocery store or the doctor or whatever.
Are you complaining about my taxi service?
No, yours was fine. And I don't dare complain about who was driving the road. Thank you.
Yeah, I was going to say, when I had my restaurant and used to have somebody that had too much to drink, and called back and never showed up.
Wow.
And they had to get people to take them home and take the keys from them or whatever. But, I mean, there was a big dollar in Mahashi's. Did the same thing. Restaurant people always had a hard time getting taxi. So when they say you don't call a cab, don't drive, well, you can't get one itself. I assume it's still the same way because I don't see any cabs around like they used to. And I'm for looking into that. I want to see more cabs out there. But more competition. More competition.
Or, I mean, we even talked about even opening it up to everyone at one point.
Who was the guy that used to own a whole bunch of cabs?
Well, years ago, Larry Bezak was the one that owned the majority of the cabs, and he had his own
dispatch system,
but then the state, ruled against just the one dispatch system. So some of the problem right now is all the independent cabs have their own dispatch. I think for the most part, yellow cabs.
I'm sure I think we should have that on the agenda just for discussion.
We will.
It is there. And who who does the pole belong to?
So what's telephone pole or what do you call it?
Because that's, I believe, in Edison Hall. I think I remember right by the old writing.
Yeah.
So I'll have to look into that to find out for sure.
Yeah, because I know it's been there a while. You know, you ride past something, but this resident said it's been 2 years and it was a result of an automobile accident. And not only is the half-cracked pole, but it's also wood lying on the ground.
Is there a pole holding anything? The one there?
Is it a guide wire or something? That caught on fire and that now is a tree broke in front of and someone went and just cut the tree up and it's just all in front of it.
The wind blew it over in the storm outside the other day. The roots are up out of the ground.
But there, someone came and cut the tree and just left it there.
I started to carry about this.
Yeah.
It was unboarded.
Yes, it's not boarded up.
Framingham.
Yeah. All right,
we'll take a look at
that. And they said it's been there, you know,
it
says January.
Yeah.
January 18th.
Everybody knows?
Yeah, we're around it.
But what they said, we cut that tree. It fell over, and we went and just sliced it up and left it. That's what the residents said. So we left the tree there. Because it was...
Was that after the storm, maybe, that cut off?
Yeah, they said the tree fell over in the storm.
Okay.
We came and just sliced up and left.
The only people that leave them are Detroit Edison.
if we actually would have cut it, we would have done something with it.
Yeah, they'll cut them up and leave them. That's their policy.
Well, it looks exactly what happened, but they thought the city did it. But please look at that.
Please take a look at it.
And it's not boarded up, so... And I went through Twickenham. We talked about those tarps. Twickenham has, I call them the new adhesive tape ones in Twickenham. These beautiful big homes, and they've got the blue and the gray tarps taped on the roof.
Yeah.